Hello.
Aye, aye. Is everybody in? It's a week in which the Notting Hill Carnival has just got underway, as you heard. Hundreds of thousands of people will be shooting each other this weekend. A week in which the Premier's son was rushed to hospital when an artist was given a small fortune of your money to stack sweets. When NASA suspiciously lost all of the original camera footage of the first moon landing. When the army admitted to a lack of soldiers to go with their lack of rifles that don't jam, vehicles with no armour and lack of care for those injured and still couldn't make the connection. A week when everyone who spelt their name right got a triple A star with bells and glitter on for their GCSEs. A week when Paul McCartney was snapped playing the doting father in a park in America where press photographers just happened to be standing. When Pluto was downgraded from a planet to a thing. And when cricket finally became interesting. I lied about that last one. So, here we are. And the ever-changing roster of the boys behind the glass, let's introduce ourselves, starting from my left. Name and star sign, please, and as an optional extra, something interesting about yourself.
Alex, Leo, I have nothing interesting about this.
Oh, come on, Alex.
It's true. No, I just have a very low self-esteem, so...
Well, that's interesting.
I couldn't possibly think there was
See, there you are, you've come up with something. Low self... Just write that down. Low self-esteem.
Phone into Anna.
Yes.
You can do your own fader, Gary.
Oh, do
See,
I do my
put
own
it,
fader?
Put it
oh.
there, especially, like Lucy.
Ah, thank you.
Can you stop fighting amongst yourselves, please? Next.
I'm Gary. Pisces, depending on which one you look at. So I'm on the edge.
Ah, the cusp.
I'm on the cusp.
Yeah, me too.
Yes. So for some reason I get annoyed when I see one that says Aries.
Yeah. I get irritated when I'm told that I'm Virgo. I'm not. I'm Leo.
Interesting thing. I went to V last weekend.
Did you now?
And it was quite fun.
Fun?
But, it wasn't very lively. There's not much atmosphere there.
Right, not much.
No, not much of that.
Huh. There's well, who did you see?
More bit of Radiohead going...
Yeah, well, they are miserablists, aren't they?
Very. But it was good.
So, you saw Radiohead?
I saw Radiohead, Editors, Morrissey, a band called The Deers. I really
How was Morrissey?
He was quite morose. I don't think there were that many people there. Everyone went to see Razorlight.
Razorlight?
On the other stage.
Oh, come on. That's Razorlight? That's embarrassing.
I know.
I mean, they're just... Oh, there's just something about that bloke that really rubs me up the wrong way. I can't stand him.
It just seems so fake with Razorlight. It just seems so calculated.
So full of himself is what I dislike most. Razorlight. Yeah, they supported The Who. I was, in the Hard Rock Cafe tent, eating while they were on. I only came out for The Who. Yeah, I saw a bit of it on TV, and it was mostly boring, I think, is the word that I'm looking for. I like Morrissey, though, because he's still got that... I like the thing he does with his mic, with his mic lead.
Oh, kind of like he's conducting or something.
Well, like he's whipping his own buttocks with the mic lead.
It is a bit bizarre.
Yeah, which might be an indication into his private life or not.
I wouldn't like to
maybe,
comment.
No, me either. But well, I did, but in retrospect, I'd better not. First call this evening is a bloke in outside of London. What a surprise. Chester. Hello, Stephen.
Hello, Nick. Hey, speaking of concerts, a friend of mine went to that same Rolling Stone concert you went to.
Yeah.
He has to pay money for it, unlike you.
Of course.
Rock and roll! I think it was about £110. He said he was that far back, he couldn't really see anything.
Well, what do you expect for if you, you know, buy a cheap seat? 110?
I wonder what yours would have cost.
150. Anyway, that's absolutely outrageous, isn't it, by the way? That's just incredible. What nerve, really? Particularly as the... Well, you tell me what he thought, and I'll tell you what I thought. You show me yours, and I'll show you mine.
He said he thought it was a really good concert, except he couldn't see much, basically.
Right.
That was his opinion. I don't know what you thought of him.
Well, I could see loads, because I was up the front. But I still found myself watching the screen. Even though I could see them in person, I still found myself watching TV. And I thought, I'm standing in the middle of a stadium. Not sitting, mind. The seats cost 150 quid, and we didn't sit down at all. Everybody in the stands sat down, but everybody down the front. Even though most of them were 160 years old, they were all standing from word go.
really surprised me that Mick Jagger would allow TV screens, because surely that would enhance all the wrinkles.
I tell you what, the thing about Mick Jagger is he's a phenomenon. He's absolutely unbelievable. It was his show, really. You went to see the Rolling Stones, and the other band members could have stayed in the hotel room and just phoned their performance in. But Mick Jagger was throwing himself around like a teenager. It was just incredible to see. And I thought, you know, halfway through, you thought, oh, he must sit down and have a breather now. He can't be running back and forth for 2 hours. And back and forth he went. And I mean, the stage was, what, I don't know, 100 yards from one end to the next, at least. And he just didn't stop running around and, you know, prancing and mincing and throwing shapes and all that stuff that he does. He was unbelievable. It was worth going just to see him. I'm not sure it was worth 150 quid just to see him, but I was pleased that I went.
I mean, it's a bit like I went to see the Eagles in Manchester a few years ago.
Ah, Joe Walsh.
Yeah, and Joe Walsh, the oldest bloke on the stage.
Is he?
And I presume he was. He looked old anyway.
That's through years of self-abuse. Not that kind, the other kind.
I mean, he was running around the stage like no tomorrow.
Joe Walsh was running?
Well, I mean, you know.
He must have had a particularly stiff coffee just before he went on, or something.
Yeah, they seem to have tons of energy.
Huh. That's not a band that you normally associate with lots of energy, or running, or indeed moving at all, the Eagles.
But they're very good.
Yes, they are.
Anyway, that's not why I rung.
Why did you ring?
Well, I noticed a thing in the... I know you like newspaper articles, and I noticed a thing in the Times, and it said, how long does it take for you to size somebody up? So you're walking down the street, right?
Minding your own affairs.
And you come up to a cash machine, you're behind somebody... And so you're in front of them, you're about to put your PIN number in, there's somebody behind you, how long does it take you to size them up?
Is this a quiz?
Well...
Is there a right or wrong answer?
No. I mean, this quiz says that they reckon you can size a person up, most people do, in 1/10 of a second.
Yeah, without even looking at them. Out the corner of your eye you can size them up. You know, yeah. And it's called... People label it as instinct. You should always trust your instincts, but it's not really instinct. It's just
intuition.
And all of those sort of sixth sense hippie notions. It's not that at all. It's just you size a person up out of the corner of your eye, just by the shape of them, because you don't really get a good look at that small time frame. Just by the shape of them, how they're moving, whether they're moving quickly towards you, with their arm raised, you know, and you make an instant decision. And always trust what are called your instincts, because they're most often right.
Well, I mean, it says that you don't even have to move a muscle. They don't need to actually do anything, and you make an instant decision there and then.
Yeah, quite right, too.
I mean, has anyone been stabbed this week, by the way?
Oh, my God. Well, I was going to start the show with the usual, has anyone been stabbed or shot this week? But it's not funny anymore, because almost 90% of this audience have been stabbed and shot moving from their living room to the kitchen.
Anyway.
Meanwhile, our top cop has said that London streets are now so safe that you can leave your front door open.
Yeah, all right.
That's what he said. He didn't say it quite so general. He was specific about a particular London street that used to be, and probably still is, a war zone. But there's a man who's really in touch, isn't it?
But then you've got those... If I was one of those three Arabs in that house that was stormed by 200 police, you'd leave your door open, wouldn't you? Because you'd have multiple protection.
Well, you might as well leave the door open, yeah. Because they're coming in anyway.
Anyway, when Aid rings up, right... Don't forget to ask him who he's been to see recently.
I will definitely forget to do that. Hey, have you ever been to the Notting Hill Carnival?
Never.
Never?
I lived in London for about 20 years, but I never went to that.
Right.
Have you ever been?
Yes, I have.
Is it good?
Good. Well, it was...
It's not rock music, is it?
No, it was, the last time I went, I think I left under a hail of stones... What, not those stones, the worst kind, while helicopters circled overhead, and I thought, nah, no, not this again. So I've never been back.
Right.
But, and I don't recommend it to anyone at all, even if you live there. But anyway, I'm sure most of the people who live there have left for the weekend.
Probably.
Yeah, well, the people who live inside houses that cost over £1 million have definitely left.
Do you think that they've got tables outside the restaurants on the street?
What, as barricades, you mean?
So people can go out for a nice meal.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, that's right. There'll be a lot of al fresco eating in Notting Hill this weekend. All right, thanks a lot, Stephen.
Bye.
Ta-ta.
Bye.
This is LBC.
Abbot. How may I help you?
Hey, Gary.
Good evening. I just want to share an experience I had at a concert I visited. I was in the States. Just imagine listening to, actually in live, Lennon McCartney do Abbey Road or rather Sergeant Pepper. But what I actually heard was Brian Wilson playing Smile, the legendary Smile album. And I just want to show you the impact that had on me, because this is one of these legendary albums that was never done, and he was supposed to equal Sergeant Pepper.
Yeah, it didn't.
But after 30 years, or 35 years, to actually listening on stage in his full glory was just absolutely amazing, you know.
Did he manage to stay awake for the whole concert?
Well, I know what you're saying, but it meant something to me. It may not be note perfect, may not be in the same perfectionist choir-style voices that I had with the rest of the Beach Boys, but what he did, it was him, the person who created the sound, was on stage emulating what could have been an all-time success. And that was an amazing experience for me. It was like kind of the Holy Grail.
This is a bit of a delayed reaction from you. I mean, this happened a long time ago. It was on TV just recently as well. And you know what? I was a little bit moved too. Even though the man cannot sing a note anymore, it was strangely moving. You're right.
But the thing is, at the time, it was dismissed, and only sort of the quality papers would consider it, acknowledge the greatness of Brian Wilson. But it was great that it finally was acknowledged 30 years later, and a lot of the media acknowledged how great Pet Sounds was, and the subsequent Lost Smile album. But and then Paul McCartney came out and said that he was very much influenced by Brian Wilson. So to me, I was a great supporter of Brian Wilson at that time, but not really appreciated by my friends. But then it's nice to kind of had the last laugh 30-35 years later.
Oh, Brian Wilson, that seaside music. You just can't beat it, can you? That was one of his. So have you ever been to the Notting Hill Carnival?
Not really. I mean, I remember when about 15 years ago, there was a sort of spirit of adventure and he enjoyed it, but now it's a little bit commercialized, I think, and you know, somebody says a budget to this, and it was something that was supposed to be very spontaneous, and now it seems a bit contrived, you know.
Well, actually, the last time I went wasn't when the police were called en masse and they were running battles in the street, which I saw from the comfort of someone's flat. The last time I went, I was in what was a main street, and I needed to use the bathroom, as the Americans would say. And I found myself wanting to get off the main street because of the parade was going round, and we were absolutely crushed in with people. And I couldn't physically make my way the 20 yards that I'd have to move to get to a side street where there weren't so many people. I just couldn't make the 20-yard move. And I thought, this is a nightmare. I'm just being dragged in any direction that the crowd goes. I have no control over where I'm going. And if you had a problem with you know, being confined in small places, then you'd be freaking out at that point. So I thought, no, not coming back.
Well, Nick, we had a shop there in Bayswater, and when we, in the 3 days before, we'd start boarding up, we treat it in fear, you know, of your property. You know, what they make out on the media is something fantastic and wonderful. It's not. The people around who've got businesses, it's almost like a loss-making time during those kinds.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, what they show on the media are, they go on Children's Day, don't they? And then they stand in front of someone who looks like they just come from Rio with all the flowers and the thing in this giant costume, and then they show a clip of that, and then they'll estimate, the police estimated a crowd of over 50 people, and then it's on to the weather on your local news. Meanwhile, people are being, you know.
I agree, it's a bit of a con, because they don't show all the police that around the background, on the back streets, protecting the public, that, you know, and they said, oh, there are only 22 arrests, and only one got a stab, as if that should be the normal. I mean, it's just ridiculous, you know.
It was a great day, yeah.
No, thanks for time, Nick.
No worries, Gary. Ta-ta. This is LBC. Of course, there was a big to-do about Pluto this week. Did anybody read about that? Oh, man, the, well, apart from the universe is actually burning out. I don't want to, freak anybody out, but we're on the verge of extinction. The universe will stop forming new stars and start to get dark. A study has found that one-fifth of the gas fuel reserves of the universe have been used. Now, how on earth would they come up with a figure like that? I mean, how would you measure it? A study has found that one-fifth of the gas fuel reserves in the universe have been used. The universe is already tightening its belt by cutting the rate of formation, say a team at the University of St Andrews in Fife in Scotland who have nothing better to do than study 10,000 galaxies. We're doomed! So we're about to go to... Oh, I forgot to tell you. The important part is that the universe will get dark in 70 billion years. So they really are spending their time well at the University of St Andrews, so telling us what's going to happen in 70 billion years' time. You think that, you know, with all the troubles there are right now, then they might have something to say about how to improve our lot now, not in 70 billion years' time. We'll all probably be dead anyway. But Pluto, this is actually really upsetting. Everybody who learnt one of those mnemonic devices for figuring out the planets in which order they come from the sun. Did you ever learn that, Alex?
No.
Yeah, it's Mercury, the Venus, Earth, Mars. I forget.
Yes.
It's my very eccentric... I read the one in the Telegraph today. My very eccentric mother... so I'm up to Venus, and then the rest of it. It wasn't a very good mnemonic device, truth be told. But a fierce backlash has begun against a decision by astronomers to strip Pluto of its status as a planet. On Thursday, experts approved a definition of a planet that demoted Pluto to a lesser category of object. But the lead scientist on NASA's robotic...
Boring!
But the lead scientist on NASA's robotic mission to Pluto has lambasted the ruling, calling it embarrassing. And the chair of the committee set up to oversee
boring.
A group...
Boring!
Yeah, he's right, it is boring. Who cares? It's a planet, it's a thing, it's up there, you can't see it with the naked eye. It'll never be important at all, ever. And they're worrying and fretting and biting their fingernails to the quick, and everybody else is shrugging their shoulders and going, what, Pluto? What, the dog, you mean? The yappy dog from the cartoon? Hello, David.
Ah, oh, good evening to you, young man.
Hello, old man.
I'm from Bayswater. The first point...
Where are you from?
Bayswater.
Oh, right.
I've lived here for 27 years.
You haven't.
And there's hardly been any problems with the carnival people at all. All the local shops this year are going to stay open.
Well, I would think that they'd try their best, yeah.
And,
like, Christmas and Easter all come at once.
And the only problem to get... people with whistling.
With what, sorry?
The whistles that they can buy from the stalls, etc.
That's the problem?
That's, for some people, it doesn't bother me. I can sleep through anything.
Right.
But the main problem...
Deaf as opposed.
The main thing I phoned up about Blair, the policeman.
Oh, that Blair, yeah.
And he is saying it's safe to leave the front doors open.
Yeah.
Generally speaking, is wrong.
Generally speaking... He's wrong.
In some cases, I live in a block of flats. He could be right.
No, he couldn't be right. Not in a block of flats. Not if your house fronts onto the street. Not in any circumstance could anybody leave their house open anywhere in this country ever.
And one thing that hasn't been mentioned: if you're broken into, the insurance is null and void with the front door.
Well, yeah, that's a small point, but yeah, you're right.
But it's never been mentioned on any phone-in.
Well, then shame on those phone-ins.
And I mean, and I include yours as well.
It has been mentioned, you just mentioned it.
Yes, for the first time.
We're clear.
I just thought people should know about it.
Well, yeah, I mean, obviously. I mean, you'd have to be a fool to leave your door open. Who does that? You'd have to up sticks, put everything in a removal lorry, and move to the 1940s to leave your door open in this country.
Yeah, when I used to live in York, which is going back 45 years, it was absolutely safe to.
Wow.
The way this country's gone is beyond belief.
I don't know. People used to nick things out of other people's houses in York, surely.
Hardly ever. It was hardly known.
Hardly known. Right, well, you see, there's a big difference then. Actually happening and known to have happened are two completely different things. And you know what's, you know what the difference between then and now is? The exchange of information has, the speed of it has just gone through the roof. I think one of the problems of the society is, perversely, one of the things that's made us, made it great is we just know so much more about what's going on.
Everyone knew each other in those days. It was a smallish community, and if there was a theft, everyone would get to know about it in about 5 minutes. But so it, and I can't remember hearing anything about it when I lived there.
Do you remember much about those times, though?
I remember a fair amount about it, yes.
And do you remember what you did last weekend? Because that's always got, that's always a problem with me. I can remember, you know, which track and how long the track was and which side it was and an album that I bought 30 years ago, but I've got no idea what I did yesterday. Quiz me. No clue.
Well, we go out for meals at weekend, my wife and myself. We like going out for meals once or twice a week.
It's you, then. You're spending more money on meals out than you are at home. Do you cook from scratch?
I can't cook.
What?
I physically can't cook.
Does your wife cook from scratch?
Sometimes, yes.
Because that's the big problem with obesity in this country. It's not that people are, well, it's partly that people are sitting on their great wobbly bottoms and not, you know, moving around much. And it's partly because they're all eating crisps and chips and white bread. But it's mostly, I'll tell you what it is, it's mostly because people don't cook from scratch anymore.
My wife does quite a bit. She gets the chicken and cooks it. Or if we go out, we don't have chips, we have salad. Mind you, we both had to.
You both had to?
We both had to be careful with our weight. We're both diabetics. And I've lost 2.5 stone in 2 years.
Hey, congratulations. Where did it go from?
Mostly my stomach.
Your stomach, right.
I don't look pregnant anymore.
Yes.
I look like a little barrel. I was 13.5 stone and I'm 5'1" and a bit.
Blimey, you must have been as wide as you were tall.
I was almost.
And now you're only,
I'm a slim, straight, 11 stone.
Well, your wife will be pleased.
Oh, she is.
She'll be pleased about the straight part, anyway.
Oh, yeah, she's lost a bit of weight as well. But I've been following her diet. She's been diabetic for a lot longer, so I followed her diet and it's helped me a lot.
Well, it's like, it's cheer all round.
Yes.
And so would you be going to Notting Hill ever again? You'd be stepping outside your door this weekend? No.
I'd be stepping outside my door, but I live more Bayswater end of, if you know, Westbourne Grove.
Bayswater?
Yes, Bishopsbridge Road area.
Of course, so when you moved into Bayswater, it was a lot different than it is now, right?
Well, there's been so much change, yes. Especially with a lot of shops, restaurants, etc.
And none of it good?
Oh, some of it has been very good. I spoke to one of your presenters on the Psychic Show. He seemed to know the area so well.
On the what show?
Psychic Show.
Oh, the Psychic. I thought it said Sidekick.
No,
Sidekick, when's that on? Oh, the Psychic Show. It's funny, because I knew you were going to say that.
And, he apparently used to live above a certain shop in the road almost opposite me.
Oh.
Actually, it's a very good shop. It's the opposite of shaming it. It's called Mr. Fish.
Name it and praise it. Mr. Fish. Is it an actual fishmonger?
It's a fish shop, eat in or take away.
Right, so not a fishmonger. Are there any fishmongers left in the whole of London? Because you have to go, if you want a wet fish, which is painfully difficult to cook properly, you have to go to the supermarket. And the wet fish counter at a supermarket always looks like, oh, I don't know, it looks like the stuff that a fishmonger would throw out. Do you know what I mean? It looks so dried, and the person behind the counter wouldn't know a fish from a chicken. And I just don't feel confident in buying it. So I end up buying something in a plastic tray covered in film, which doesn't please me much, because, you know, it's probably been sitting there for, like, a week. But you just can't get fresh fish no more.
I can't remember the last time I could find fresh fish in London. And yet, going back to when I lived in York, there was plenty of it about.
Oh, I think we should all go, I think we should all get in Doctor Who's a time machine and go back to live in York, where you could leave your front door open and then you get fresh fish in the morning.
Now I don't know, but in those days you could.
All right, well, listen, thanks a lot, David. It's been a pleasure.
Same here.
Ta-da. Yeah, there was a pause before he said that. I'm not sure he's quite convinced. And this weekend, if you go outside your house in Bayswater, be armed.
There's only one home event this bank holiday, your M&S home event, with up to 30% off all furniture, from coffee table...
Yes, the Reuters News Agency, I noticed that the cameraman for Reuters News Agency managed to find themselves an armoured car. The British Army can't find them anywhere. We got no idea whether we ordered them, like in last September, and the guy said he was going to bring them over, but there was a problem with the colour, and didn't have the right stereo. Prime Minister's got an armoured car, but no one in Baghdad seems to be able to get their hands on one. Never mind, eh? And, a plane filling with smoke. And the pilot came on and said, please don't panic. We're landing in Reykjavik. That must have been pretty upsetting. Not only is the plane filled with smoke, but we're landing in Reykjavik. Anybody think of anything good about Reykjavik? I mean, it'll be dark, everyone will be committing suicide, anything else? You can't get a drink. That's it. Ice everywhere. Let's have, Jackie in...
I'm on.
You're on. It's you.
Hi.
Hey, Jackie.
Hi. I just wanted to ring up and say that I leave my door open. I live in a little village in Suffolk, and regularly my doors are open overnight as well.
Why?
Well, because we have no crime where we are. You know, we just do. You know, it's such a small village, and everybody knows everybody, and everybody does it.
When you say you leave it open, what do you mean by that?
Well, I leave it... open when the weather's nice. I actually leave the door physically open. I leave the back door open more than the front, because the front's only about 5'6" or something. You know, it's only really small.
Your front door is 5'6" high.
Yeah, about 5'6", 5'8".
Are you the little old woman who lived in a shoe?
No, I'm not old.
Is your cottage made of gingerbread? 5'6".
Yeah, it's only a tiny door. Well, people were smaller years ago, weren't they?
They were, yeah, that's true.
I moved from Liverpool. There was a lot of crime there.
Liverpool? I would never have guessed. Oh. You haven't lost your accent at all.
Well, I moved out from Liverpool because it was shocking. I was getting burgled constantly.
Dreadful place, anyway.
Yeah, but I leave my door open.
Well, that seems, even if it is, even if there's not been a single instance of recorded crime in history in your little village.
Yeah.
Where is it? Eriswell.
Eriswell it is.
It just seems a bit strange behaviour to leave your door open and then go to sleep. I mean, you've made a conscious decision to do that, rather than the normal thing that people would do, would be lock their doors and lock their windows when they go to bed. That just seems like the normal thing to do, whereas you've made a conscious decision to step outside the norm, Jackie.
But it's not a conscious decision, it's just something I've done gradually since I've moved there, you know. It's, I don't know, I feel safer than I, you know.
And wouldn't you feel safer if you lock your door?
No, not really. Oh. I would anywhere else. Anywhere else, if I stay... When I stay in a hotel, I lock the door, obviously, or, you know... But when I'm at home, I feel safe enough to leave my door open.
But you know why? It's because you haven't been the victim of a crime yet.
Well, I've been a victim of many crimes.
Right, well, you know, I mean, in Eriswell.
Well, no, I think we've got one of the lowest crime rates in the country.
Well, see, and everybody in Greenwich who's listening to this are rubbing their hands with glee, and they're deciding to take the bus. They'll be with you shortly.
Huh. I'm not the youngest person there. They're all about 90.
Well, I'm a bit concerned, Jackie. Will you at least consider putting a lock on your door?
Well, it's only the back door. The front door's locked, obviously, because I don't use it. But
it's too small to get out of.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, but the back door. No, I just leave it.
And so, a place that's only got a door that's 5'6" to get into. How big a place is this? Is it one up, one down?
No, it's a three-bedroom cottage. Actually, my husband's 6'4".
Where does he live?
He has to walk around ducking from all the beams.
Have you got a thatched roof?
No, we haven't got a thatched roof.
Right.
No.
Well, there goes my little image of a beautiful rustic living with roses around the door, and oh, it's just lovely.
I've got roses around my door.
Oh, well, okay, you saved it just at the end, though. All right, well, thanks a lot, Jackie.
All right.
If you live through the week, give us a call next week, all right?
Okay, we'll
do. Cheers, dear. Ta-ra.
Bye-bye.
This is LBC. I'm Nick Abbott. Let's go with Claire. Hello,
Hi,
Claire.
Hi, good evening. I'm just going to take my car, going to rob the house.
You what, sorry?
The back in front of the house is open.
You what?
I'm just making a joke. It doesn't matter.
Oh, I stepped
you
all over it.
Fish.
It was a joke.
I live in Temple. Hello, are you listening?
Yes, for every word.
I live in Temple Fortune.
Where's yeah, that?
It's, you know, Goldfield Station.
Oh, yeah.
About 5 minutes from
righto.
There. We have a lovely fish shop there called Stoller. S-T-O-R-S-T-O-L-E-R. It's got gorgeous fresh fish.
It must be the only one in London. I mean, apart
well,
from...
There's two fish shops in that area, but Stoller is lovely. It's been an old firm. Gorgeous. Got fresh fish and fried fish and sells fresh eggs, and it's gorgeous.
Right.
Got
eggs. That's a strange combination. Fish and eggs.
No, like, well, like, eggs is by the way.
Like me.
But they sell all kosher fish. So if you fancy nice, clean, kosher fish, come to Temple Fortune.
Right. It's a little out of my way. Temple Fortune.
What is your way?
I'm south of the river.
Well, Temple Fortune is not so far. It's lovely. Lovely area.
Right. An estate agent would call that North Hampstead, wouldn't they?
No, Northwest.
Northwest Hampstead.
Yes.
Right.
This lady's advertising a house, isn't she?
Who?
This lady who just been in before me, been on before me, telling it was so safe to have doors open.
Well, it would add 10 grand to the property, yeah.
Okay, have a nice evening.
All right, thanks, Claire.
Bye.
Hey, it was just an advert for a fish shop. Let's go with... I should have asked her if she'd been to the Notting Hill Carnival. Hello, Pat.
Hi, Nick.
Oh, it's a bloke. Yes Pat. I bet people make that mistake all the time.
Pardon?
Never mind. So, have you ever been to the Notting Hill Carnival?
I'm sorry, I haven't been able to get your name. I've been listening to your programme, but every time your name comes up, I haven't got it right, like, you know.
Right.
And I thought I got it right from your presenter there, but obviously I'm wrong again, like, you know.
Not listening to a word anyone says. It's Nick, Pat.
Nick?
Yes. Not Mick. Nick. Oh, he's dead.
N with an I-C-K or M with an I-C-K?
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
Which one? Nick.
Nick with an N, not Nick with an M, because Nick
well,
with an M goes
Nick.
Mick, not Nick.
Well, I did say Nick.
Yeah.
All right. No, it was just you were talking about being able to get fresh fish there, like, you know. And in my local supermarket, they have a fresh fish counter where you can get the fresh fish straight away.
Right.
Yeah, it's, you know, the people are saying you can't get fresh fish any longer, but you can do. All you got to do is have a look around and see, like,
and
you know,
go to the fish counter, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, they do have a
it's as simple as
in
that.
In the supermarket, it's a separate part of the supermarket,
right.
And the
and
fish
can,
are there.
Right, you can find it, because it's got fish counter written on it, yeah. And it's where all the fish
no,
are.
No, no.
Just follow your nose.
Well, no, not really, because leave it off in the supermarket. You've got so many smells in there, like, you know.
Yeah, bread and, well, just bread. I think they manufacture a bread smell, whether they're making it or not, and they pump it out so that you'll feel hungry as you're going
well,
around.
Actually, they do make their own bread on there anyway.
Yeah, but I think that they also, on top of that, also produce a, I'm sure they buy it in bulk, a bread smell, and then just waft it around the supermarket so that you're feeling hungry. And the worst thing to do when you're shopping for food...
you're a bleeding cynic.
Is, no, it's just the truth, mate, is,
you're a cynic.
Well, that's, being cynical is also being realistic. The worst thing when you're shopping is to be shopping hungry, because you buy way more than you actually need, and you end up throwing half of it away, but the supermarkets are coining it in.
Because I usually have my breakfast before I go shopping, so I don't go in hungry anywhere.
Right.
Yeah?
Well, this is like a snapshot of your life, Pat. So, how long have you been living in Peckham? I'll come back to you
20,
on that one.
20-odd years.
20 years?
Yeah.
Have you ever been to the Notting Hill Carnival?
Nope.
Right. Well, it's been an inspiration. Thanks a lot, Pat.
Okay, good
cheers,
night.
Mate. Ta-ra. So, in order to get fresh fish, all you need to do is go to the supermarket, to the fresh fish counter. I was completely wrong. I've lost count of the ways in which I've been so wrong. Has anyone been to the Notting Hill Carnival? Has it started today, or is it Sunday and Monday?
Sunday and Monday.
Right, so nothing will be happening today.
Don't think so.
No, it kicked off at 8 this evening.
Yeah, there is
there's,
something.
Steel bands, I think.
See, that's what you'll see on the local news. Notting Hill Carnival kicked off today, and they'll have a shot of A very uncrowded street with people playing those irritating drums.
And there'll be a smiling Bobby dancing.
Bobby will be dancing with someone in a costume. Yeah, that's right. And please go to the Notting Hill Carnival. It'll be super fun. And meanwhile, when you get there, you can't move in any direction. Everyone is like jostling you, and there's 150,000 policemen who have they've sprayed on there like some sort of like a Damien Hirst spray painting. They're just all over the place, and it doesn't look too festive or carnival-like, and you can't see anything or go anywhere, and it's just an absolute nightmare, and you regret going there from the moment you arrive. And I don't believe I've ever been to Notting Hill again, either during the carnival or not. Why would anybody want to live there? I just don't understand. It's gone through the roof, the property prices in there, partly because of that that dull film that they made, which was called Notting Hill. Clues in the title. But why anyone would choose to live there? I mean, if you had £5 million to spend on a house, would you want to go and live in Notting Hill?
No!
No. You'd have to be off your chump. So, Ewan Blair. See, the Prime Minister's got a lot to be concerned about without worrying about his kids. This is the kid that was found flat in his face in Leicester Square a little while ago, right? Because he did the very typical student thing of getting drunk. Was it after his exams? Something like that. And his mates... he was out drinking with his mates, right? And it's just a teenager who couldn't handle his booze, you know, and you can't. None of us could when we first started drinking. It takes years of practice. And as soon as he hit the ground, his mates just disappeared. They vanished, disparu, like a South American dictator. And they just left him there for the police to pick up. Nice mates. Tony Blair, like, he doesn't have enough to think about. He's just come back to all manner of disasters. Britain's top cop has put his foot in it again, and everything has gone pear-shaped. The interest rates, the inflation rate, which they've been promising us is virtually nothing at all, has been found to be a lie, and inflation is actually through the roof because they haven't included... They've wisely not included anything in the inflationary basket that has actually gone up in price. Yeah, they've discluded all of that. And they shrug their shoulders and just go, what? When people say, well, hang on a minute. Everything has gone up apart from everything in your basket. And so he's been found out on that. Everybody that showed up to take a GCSE passed with an A star. And they're still claiming that they're not dumbing down exams, you know, and the war over there, pretty shortly we're going to go and have to invade Iran. And we're also going to have to invade Russia because they're upset because everybody's getting upset with Iran. And the leader of Iran is called I'm Mad in the Head. Look at the spelling. That's what he's called. And all of this stuff is going on. And his son had to get rushed to hospital. Here's the story. The Prime Minister's eldest son, Ewan Blair, spent yesterday in hospital in Barbados after suffering from the worst case of facial hair ever seen. You seen this kid? If only this was TV and we could pop this photo up. I'll hold it up for you there behind the glass. I don't know if you can get that. It's awful. The 22-year-old who was taken to hospital 2 years ago in Egypt was admitted to the Queen Elizabeth Hospital on the island's Bridgetown after passers-by doubled up in hysterics. I haven't seen so much fuzz since I last bought a punnet of peaches. Oh, seriously, mate, I'm going to send him a mirror in the post. That is awful. But you can't tell him, can they? You know, you can't... he thinks he looks like... Oh, I don't know, but probably that guy from Pirates of the of Penzance. Not Penzance, Pirates of the Caribbean. Johnny Depp. Is that the guy's name?
What's that?
Yeah, Jack Sparrow.
Right. He probably thinks he looks as rakish as Keith Richards himself. But actually, it looks like looks like an accident in a cotton wool factory. It's embarrassing. I mean, for the male of the species, I think he's letting us all down. Whoops, I just hit you. Here's one in Wimbledon. Ursula.
Hi, Nick.
Hey, Ursula.
You're just a barrel of laughs, aren't you?
A barrel of laughs.
Yes. And positivity.
Yes, that's me.
Well, I was calling up to let you know that I'm definitely going to the Notting Hill, you know, carnival.
Don't do it.
No, well, I'm going with 30 people.
Oh, okay, you're going with a posse.
So it should be lots of fun. And, well, it'll be a lot different than, you know, last year where I went by myself because I didn't really know anybody.
You know, when I went to Notting Hill Carnival, you'd go with people back in the olden days when people didn't have mobile phones. You'd have to arrange, if you got lost, you'd have to arrange to meet people at certain points. And those points became inaccessible to human beings because you couldn't actually move through the crowd to get to them. So if you lost people that you went with, they were lost for the day.
Well, we've already said that we're not backtracking.
Oh, that's nice. So if one of your lot falls, then they can fend for themselves.
Basically. Nice. Well, just going back is going to be pretty hard. That's just going to frustrate, you know, the whole crowd. So, I mean, we're supposed to meet up later at some pub, but, I mean, through the afternoon, we're not backtracking.
But you do have your mobile phones.
Yes. Definitely do have mobile phones, and thinking it should be lots of fun. I mean, last year I went on the Monday, and I didn't really see any problems at all.
Is it Children's Day on Monday?
No, Children's Day is tomorrow,
Sunday. Right. Is it actually a family-friendly children's event on Sunday, or is it exactly the same?
You know, I don't know, because I've only been here a year and some, and so this is my second Notting Hill, you know, carnival. But I can't, you know, imagine that it's going to be much different, because the one on Monday last year had lots of kids, and it was kids in the parade. So, what's going to be the difference? I don't really know.
Yeah.
Either way, it will bring me back to my youth, since I grew up in this little tiny island that nobody's ever heard of.
Test me.
It's called Montserrat.
Montserrat? How can you not have heard of Montserrat? I'd have trouble pinpointing it on a map, but I've heard of it.
Why have you heard of it?
Well, isn't that this kind of place that the Rolling Stones go for a summer holiday? Didn't Keith Richards fall out of a tree in Montserrat?
Yeah, I think they had a summer house or something down there. But most people know of it because there was a volcano down there about 10 years ago. And 2/3 of the island is covered in ash.
Well, how come you sound like an American?
Because I grew up in the U.S.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I grew up in Boston. But
Boston? Yeah. I quite like Boston. When I went there about 150 years ago now, there was a big thing with tea in the harbour. I can't remember what they were going on about.
Yeah, something about tax.
But it was a very terrible English place. I thought it was the most English of all American cities.
Well, I was just, you know, I like to say that it's probably more English than the English. Because, you know, you guys are, like, since I've moved over here, I'm like, what's up with all this modern, you know, IKEA crap that's, you know, considered furniture? No offense to, you know, the IKEA generation.
Oh, yeah. Like, no offense to the second richest man on the planet who will sue us into a black hole in space if he ever hears this. Yeah. The only difference is that we take tea at 3 in the afternoon, and the people that I was staying with at Boston smoked it. That's the only difference I can think of.
Oh, I've never been next to that stuff, so I wouldn't
know. Of course
not.
No. So what are you doing over here? Dodging the authorities?
What?
Keeping one step ahead of the immigration officials?
No. I transferred with my company. I work for a consulting company.
Oh, that sounds very suspicious. Consulting. It sounds like so vague. It could be anything, couldn't it? Are you from the FBI?
No, it's finance and accounting. Stuff to do with Sarbanes-Oxley.
As soon as you said the word accounting, like, my brain just switched right off. I'm sorry.
Yeah, mine too, for that matter.
Do you like your job?
Yeah, for the most part.
Is that a no?
Radio.
That's a no, isn't it?
Yeah, I do. I do. I mean, I meet and talk to lots of interesting people.
Yeah,
so
sure you do. A lot of interesting people that earn a lot more than you do. That's the nightmare of being an accountant, is that you're doing people's accounts and millions and millions of pounds they're earning for basically putting their feet up and striking up a cigar, and you're there tapping out on your little calculator day in, day out, trying to save them money.
Well, I don't actually do the accounting. I just sell the service.
Oh, you're the pusher?
Yeah.
You're the pusher man.
Yeah.
And how's life in Wimbledon? You like Wimbledon? Nice and green and...
I like Wimbledon. It's nice, but it's a little bit too far from the action.
See, I knew you were going to say that. It's a little bit too far away.
I wish I lived in Notting Hill.
No, you don't. Wimbledon would be a lot nicer place to live.
But, well, not for a single person.
Ah, right.
I mean, if you...
A lack of hot totty, is that what you're saying?
You know, it's like, oh, man, you're always having to worry about catching that last train.
Definitely. I went to town on my birthday. And I came out and I got the very last train. And if I hadn't got the last train, then I probably wouldn't be sitting here by now. I'd be in prison because I would have taken a cab and I wouldn't have been able to pay for it because it would have cost, what, about £10,000 from the middle of London to out where I live. And I don't live as far away as you do.
What? Wow. So you wouldn't have taken, like, the night bus or anything?
Well, you know what? The night bus, I left Childish Things behind about 20 years ago. I never want to see the inside of a night bus again.
Well, I've taken it once, and I was like, okay, once is way too much.
Yeah, once is definitely enough, yeah. You never know if you're going to arrive alive, or just at all, ever.
Yeah, it was kind of a scary experience, and I'm a big city, you know, gal, but that was too much.
Yeah, I can remember you go home on the night bus and every fibre of your body is hoping that there's going to be no problems. Then you're speeding along and you think, oh, blimey, this is as quick as a cab. And then it'll stop on one stop and then it stops and it stops and it stops. And you think, oh, God, what's happening? And then the worst thing in the world happens. The driver switches off the engine. Oh, no.
You overslept?
No, he's just, there's been someone who's got on who's causing some altercation.
Oh.
They haven't got the right money, or they're smoking, or they're giving him abuse, or something like this. So he switches the thing on, everybody's eyes go to the roof. And, oh, my God, another one of these.
Yeah, well, that wasn't my experience, but it just took forever, and there were just too many drunks.
Yeah, way too many drunks.
Like, okay.
Did you ever pick up on a night bus?
No.
It's just the last desperate gasp for going home on your own. No.
I don't mind going home on my own. Right. I mean,
okay, good for you, Ursula.
Yeah, then I don't have to roll over and, you know, wonder, what the hell?
Who are you? Yeah. How did I get here? Yeah. All right, listen, thanks a lot, Ursula.
Okay.
Ta-da.
Good talking to you. Bye.
This is LBC. Should we take the break now? Now.
Take 100.
Would you mind telling me what this is all about?
Adrian.
Hello, Nick.
It's Aid Who Can Get Laid.
How are you doing?
I'm all right, mate.
Yeah,
how are you?
Yeah, not too bad.
Good
yeah,
week? You sound down.
Down?
Yeah.
No, I'm just a bit snuffly again.
Oh, right. That'll be your chronic cocaine habit.
Don't tell everybody. So I'm talking of habits. How are you?
I tell you what, if you want to get into the media, you have to have a chronic cocaine habit because it'll shoot you ahead. It really will. Just ask Kate.
I remember that. Yeah, talking of habits before I get moved on. How are you doing 8 days now that Big Brother's finished?
Well, first of all, I thought,
oh no,
what are they all doing? I thought, because you know we've been a part of their lives for so long, and I thought, what are they doing? And it's none of our business anymore, which I find outrageous. How dare they?
Yeah, look, I'm on this morning very soon.
And you know, as soon as it stopped, I did get a bit of a withdrawal thing, and I thought, and I felt a little funny in my brain.
I feel lightheaded. That's what I feel.
You can get that.
Hang on. That's the best bit. You almost stepped all over the best bit. Are you insane?
That is on YouTube now, isn't it? The bottled water thing.
Is it? It's one of the greatest things I've ever seen on television. I mean,
come to see which television.
Oh,
yeah. Anyway, moving on from the depressing stuff.
Yeah.
If you had seen, like, the updated, old public information films recently.
Yeah, one did come by the other day, and wasn't it one that was the guy who's waving, not drowning, or drowning, not waving?
Yeah.
It's two, like a fat bloke and his wife with gigantic hair and teeth sit on a beach, and some blokes, and they're northern types, and someone's waving from the sea, and they're in trouble, and they go down for the third time, and they're like, oh, what should we do, or something like that, I can't remember.
That is exactly the sort of person you wouldn't want if you're drowning.
Yes, a clueless dope, yeah.
But we noticed that it looks exactly the same as it did years ago, apart from it uses a mobile phone now.
Are we talking about the same film?
Yeah, it's the same, except they've changed it for a mobile phone instead of going to a phone box.
Really? Because you only need, because the phone boxes are only used as toilets now, aren't they?
Yeah.
Just before you get on the night bus, because you don't want to pee on the night bus, because it's the big sign. It used to say no spitting on the top deck, now it says no peeing. Yeah. How times have changed.
I just hope if I'm ever drowned, I don't have reliance on even a mobile phone, because it's probably over flat, I've got no signal. It'd be dead by the time I got through it.
Yeah, quite.
But But,
they'll put you on hold. Coast Guard's a bit busy, you know, like the police. They're concentrating on speeders at the moment. If you've been stabbed or shot, we'll put you on hold. Please hold.
Unless you're in the police and,
and then you can do anything you like, yeah.
But,
oh, dear. I'll get to that.
You have a legit the Jimmy Savile thing, clunk-click. Jimmy Savile telling you to put your seatbelt on.
Yeah. And you almost don't want to do it just because it's Jimmy Savile telling you to do it.
If I was in the car with Jimmy Savile, I'd want to fly up.
What has that man done to receive such, such abuse? He had a great theme tune. It was, Ramsey Lewis Trio, wasn't it? Yeah, you remember his theme tune?
What, Jim Will Fix It?
Not Jim Will Fix It, you know, his old radio show.
Well, I mean,
there used to be a lot of strange people on the radio. Now they've all been smoothed over so that everyone is kind of beige. But there used to be a lot of characters on the radio. Don't you remember? Like about 20 years ago, there used to be people who would, who some people would love and others would absolutely object to. Now focus groups have made everyone, have smoothed the corners off everyone on the radio. So now there are no characters anymore.
It was mostly on the Pirates, that's why, weren't
he? Was Jimmy on the Pirate stations?
I don't know if Jimmy was, but he probably was. Well, everybody virtually come out of the 60s on the Pirates.
Yeah, I didn't do that. I asked about going on Radio Caroline. You remember Radio Caroline? Ding, ding, ding. From a pointed sea to the circles of your mind. This is the new Radio Caroline. Of course you do. And somebody told me, oh, well, you know they don't pay you any money. And I said,
what?
Don't pay you any money? And there my interest waned.
And I missed my chance of going on that, because I was about 14 at the time. I was about 5 inches too small to actually go on the boat trip. And now, of course, I'll never get to go.
There was a boat trip?
People used to go out to Caroline quite a lot. And take on things they shouldn't talk to, like...
Yeah, but bearing gifts of, you know, drinkable water, that sort of thing. It sounds like a complete nightmare, because apart from anything else, there's nothing to do on there but do a radio show, and you are, horror of horrors, stuck on a boat with DJs. Yes. There's nowhere to go, and there's no one to talk to but DJs. That sounds like my personal definition of hell.
Hey, that could be, that's a new idea, another reality TV in the making, isn't it?
Stick everyone on a boat and make them do a radio show. Hey!
That would be great.
Yeah, you're really making me bilious, Aid. But thanks very much for the input, all right.
Okay. Yeah.
Another satisfied customer.
On FM.
Do it.
I'll tell you who's funny, who made me laugh this week. Ian Lee, that's who. Somebody sent me a link to... He appeared on a celebrity version of... oh, God, what's that programme with the woman who's fashioned herself as the quiz bitch? What's that called?
Not Mastermind.
Weakest Link.
Not Mastermind, no.
Weakest Link.
Was Ian on Mastermind?
Yeah.
Was he?
Well, it's not been aired yet.
Really? He's on Mastermind?
Mm-hmm.
He must be a giant brain. What's his specialist subject?
The monkeys.
I take that back. The monkeys?
What?
You're kidding. How can anybody... Well, what's to know? They were put together a fake band.
I think it was the monkeys and general knowledge.
Well, you have to do general knowledge, don't you?
Okay.
I mean, even the general knowledge questions stump me. Occasionally you get one right. And,
Cheers for celebration.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, if you can get more right on Mastermind than you can on University Challenge, then that's about right, actually, because University Challenge is completely befuddling to me. I mean, I went through university, and what these people are learning is just beyond me. I've got no clue. None whatsoever. I'm totally stupid compared to those people.
My college tried to put a team together once, and I think there wasn't enough people intelligent.
Yeah, I think that's exactly the same thing happened with mine. They invited Brunel to put together a panel, and I don't think we could come up with one. How embarrassing. So when are they going to put this Mastermind thing on the air?
I think it's September.
Is Ian a giant brain?
Just a giant, I think. Full stop.
And who else is going to be on it?
Wasn't one of the Radio 1 presenters on it?
Oh, no.
I can't remember which one. Sorry.
DJ Spoonie.
Could have been. Hey. I don't think it was whoever does Drive Time, but I can't remember. Scott Mills.
All right.
Was on it.
You do forget, don't you? Because these days it's like, you just got no idea who it is.
For ages.
Who is DJ Spoonie? Did I get that right?
Yeah. I mean,
that's just a name that I dragged off the air.
Is he
out of
Garage? I believe.
He's banging techno or something.
Oh, right. DJ Spoonie. You know that DJs have adopted those silly names in order to avoid paying tax? Because if you appeared as, hey, I'm DJ N, then who are the taxmen going to go after? They've got no idea who you are. Are they going to wait for you to come out of a club at 6 o'clock in the morning? I don't think so. So that's what they do. That's what they do. Not that I'm saying that DJ Spoonie did it for those reasons, but that's basically why all DJs called stupid names, is to avoid paying tax. Of course, as a DJ, you're lucky to get paid at all, because you're mostly working for gangsters. Not that I'm saying that gangsters run, London's clubs. Oh, no, that's right. That is what I'm saying. Yeah. you're lucky to get out with your life. Just the thought of being a club DJ doesn't appeal to me in any way, shape or form. You? I mean, I'm sitting here on a, well, I was going to say comfortable, but it's not a comfortable chair, is it? It's an architect designed chair. But I think comfort went out the window. Form does not follow function with these chairs. Although they have a lot of fans. It's a design classic, and it costs about £1,300 each, aren't they?
They're very expensive.
Very, very expensive.
You see, next door, they've got a new one for Anna Rabin.
Have they?
Yeah, a special one.
What, next door there?
Next door there.
Can I just take a peek now?
Yeah, it's greyer. It's the grey one, I think.
Huh. Am I stepping into hot water here? Why does Anna need a special chair?
I don't think it's any...
It's her bad back.
Is it?
Back. She has a bad back.
These chairs are supposed to be ergonomically correct, but you know what? I find them deeply, deeply uncomfortable, because they cut off circulation to you. They're called... should we even mention them now that I'm slagging them off? Perhaps not.
Maybe not, no.
No. Okay, what was I talking about? Ian Lee, that's right. Yeah, he was on that quiz show with the woman who's fashioned herself as TV's quiz bitch. What's that show called?
The Weakest Link.
The Weakest Link is the correct answer. And, he was properly funny on that. I mean, apart from the things that he was saying was funny, what struck me most was what a good physical comedian was. I mean, it was very subtle, because you don't want to be overblown on TV, because it's like a big close-up on you. But, and of course, as a physical, your physical comic abilities are lost on the radio. You should do more telly, Ian. Is he listening? Is this thing on?
He probably is, actually. Right.
Okay,
Let's have one in Enfield. Hello, Chris.
Hi.
Chris.
Hello.
Hello, Chris.
Hello. Right, you were talking about wet fish.
Oh, yeah.
In Edmonton Green, North London, they have got a beautiful one. They do all type of fish, and if you want it gutted, they will do it while you wait, and they are fantastic.
Well, I'm gutted because I don't live anywhere near North London.
Oh, well, I'm sorry.
Well, there's nothing to be sorry about. So do you cook from scratch? You get something that looks like it was once alive? And
I always cook from scratch. My husband won't eat nothing frozen.
Right. And I imagine that you're not gigantically fat.
Well, I'm about 12, 13 stone.
Right, okay, so that's not gigantically fat for someone of your...
It is, but never
mind. Your maturity. I'll put it like that, shall I?
Yeah.
Yeah.
A bit overfed.
Well, you know, I mean, when you get to a certain age, you don't want to go jogging, do you?
No, I definitely don't.
No, of course. No, I'd never wanted to go jogging. Not now, not ever, never.
I'd run after the kids, grandchildren, off the road if they were. But other than that, I don't think I can do that.
Right, when you run after them, are you carrying a stick?
No, don't need it.
Do you ever tell them to go outside and get you a switch?
No.
Right. But that's the problem, and I'll talk about the fat thing in a second, once we've had a little chat. But, so what have you been up to this week then, Chris? Do people just assume that you're a male person?
No, I'm a female.
Yeah, I know you are. I mean, I did, yeah.
No. What am I up to?
I initially thought, Chris...
I'm going to do a lot of cooking because my husband's West Indian, and I'm having a few friends round over on Bank Holiday Monday to have a game of cards and dominoes, like they all do.
Yeah, so what is it with them and dominoes? It's...
I don't know.
And the way they play it as well, they smash the dominoes down on the table.
Oh, it's their way, I suppose.
Yeah.
It's nice, I like that.
Because I used to live in Clapham North.
Oh, well, that's where, at the moment, my husband is near Clapham. He's gone down to play some cards and dominoes. I told him to clear off that for a while so I can finish doing bits and pieces.
Oh, your business, right.
Sorting out all my music.
Your music?
Yeah, I like my tapes just so if he's having friends around.
What kind of music? Anything like this?
No. Lovers rock, reggae, soul, anything like that.
Right, I haven't got any of that.
Country and western.
How about this?
Yo, tell me what I want, what I really, really want. So tell me what you want, what you really, really want. I wanna really, really, really wanna zig a zig.
Got any of that?
No, my grandchildren like all that. So does my friend when she listens to you.
Right. Right, so you've sent him away and you're doing your business and, probably...
I'm doing my cooking.
Probably having a drink.
No, I don't have a drink. I've got enough. When I went to Jamaica in April, I brought some rum back with me and the drink's here and I don't drink it.
Right, so you brought rum back with you and you haven't touched a drop?
Oh, I do drink it, but I don't like to drink indoors. If I go out and socialise, yes, but... I suppose when his friends come around, I will socialise and have a little drop, but otherwise, right. It can stay there. If I'm sat indoors on my own, I can't be bothered.
I used to be like that. Oh, indoors on your own, yeah. Yeah, I don't drink when I'm on, well, sometimes. But I, when I used to work in a pub, when I was in Clapham North, I used to work in a pub called the Landor. Which at the time is this big, scary place. I think they've, the entire area has been gentrified a little bit since then. Now they've got cappuccino bars, if you please.
Oh, yeah.
But I used to work in the Landor during the daytime when people used to queue up outside at 11:30 to get in.
We used to go to, you know, Clapham Roundabout? Where Dougie's is now, called Dougie.
Clapham Roundabout?
Yeah, and there used to be a pub there as well. Yeah.
Right, well, that's nice, but we're talking about me now.
Oh, sorry.
I'm kidding. And, because there was a very heavy Jamaican population, not heavy, but it was heavily populated with Jamaicans around there, and they always used to come in, and they used to play dominoes with great vim and bordering on aggression, yeah.
Yeah.
Seems like such a gentle game until you see those old geezers play it, yeah. Huh, well, anyway, and hope you enjoy your...
Sorry. Anyhow, you take care, and if you do come to North London, go and visit.
Right, I absolutely won't do that. But thanks a lot, Chris.
Take care.
Ta-da, what a nice lady. This is LBC 97.3.
If you are planning to...
Now, I find this very suspicious. How about you? The original film of man's first steps on the moon has been, guess what? That's right. Lost. Now, it's one thing for the BBC to wipe all the Derek and Clive... Not Derek and Clive, Pete and Dud. They didn't... they probably did wipe all the Derek and Clive because it was a bit too racy for broadcast. We should play that. I'll bring that in next week and we'll play it in full. Wouldn't that be a good idea?
No!
No. But they wiped all of Pete and Dud, which has made Pete and Dud glow in the memory because we haven't got any... I haven't got much evidence to disprove the notion that they were... that those two TV programmes were... actual, real-life, solid gold genius. Until one came up the other... Was it last year? They discovered one in Australia. And they put it on the air, and it was freshly not funny. And you thought, maybe they'd better stay lost. But losing the original film of man's first steps on the moon, that seems, well, suspicious. The footage of Neil Armstrong's historic moment is one of the most important artifacts of the 20th century. Well, it absolutely is. I mean, it's the first time we stepped off this world and onto another. I mean, in another 100 years, we might be, jaunting off where no man has gone before and, blasting people into space. We'll start a list. Who do you want being blasted into space? I mean, that list will be never-ending. So they, they should have put that in under lock and key, don't you think? I mean, that's can you think of a more important piece of footage than that? I mean, wars come and go, and I know they're awful, and people die, and so on and so forth. But for the advancement of the human race, I mean, although we didn't get much from that specific mission, it was the first step because we're eventually going to have to leave this planet or die on it because the sun's going to get so hot that we'll all fry. So we're going to have to move eventually, and that the first step. I mean, it's like a parent's taping over the film of their child taking its first steps in order to watch Coronation Street. It's just nuts. While the television broadcast seen by 600 million people in July 1969 is preserved for posterity, the original tapes from which the footage was taken have been mislaid in the vast archive in the United States Space Agency NASA. And here's where it becomes suspicious. The footage could transform our view of the moon landings, offering images far sharper than the blurred, grainy video shown around the world. Because you've seen that footage over and over, right? And it could have been done in your back garden. It's in a snowstorm. It could be a shot of anything. It could also lay to rest the conspiracy theory that the landings were faked on a Hollywood soundstage. This is the bit where it becomes suspicious. Despite its iconic status, the television footage was the equivalent of a photocopy of a photocopy. It came from a camera that had been... This is amazing. The footage that we know of the moon landing actually came from a camera that had been pointed at a black and white monitor on Earth. So, in other words, it was a photograph of a TV that was showing the actual footage. Isn't that incredible? Like, they couldn't just wire in the original. Which further emboldens the conspiracy theorists. The image on a monitor, in turn, had already been stripped of much of its detail. To make sure that the transmission would make it to Earth, the images sent from Apollo 11 were recorded at 10 frames per second and had to be converted to 60 frames per second in order to be broadcast, and in the process, much of the detail was lost. An expert said, what was broadcast to the world was nowhere near as good as what was received. A bloke in one of the three tracking stations that taped the original footage before sending it to Houston in converted form. But rather than being prized as vital recordings, NASA simply filed them away. And as personnel retired or died, the location of the tapes was forgotten. I'll put forgotten in inverted commas. So in other words, there's crystal clear, extra sharp images of the ones that we've only ever seen the grainy footage of. And they're expecting us to believe that it was all a coincidence. Does anybody believe it was all a coincidence?
No!
No. Or do we?
They'll turn up on eBay soon enough.
that's a good point, yeah. Hey, Matt.
Good evening.
How are you?
I'm very well, yourself?
I'm all right. You're in Wigan.
Yes.
What do you want to be in Wigan for?
Listen, I apologise. I've been out. I've had a few lubricants. Well... I've had a few jars, because I won the lottery tonight.
Booze!
You won the lottery?
Yeah, tonight, yeah.
How much?
Well, I'm not saying this is going to change my life, Nick, but it might do. I actually got three numbers.
Whole £10?
Yeah, I won £10. Now, I'm debating now whether to go and see my banker on Tuesday after the bank holiday. No, you have to excuse me, I'm just...
Mate, in Wigan, you probably get, 86 pints for £10?
No, I've actually bought the street. And you know what?
It needs renovation? I bet it does, yeah.
No. I've bought the whole street, parking, cars, everything, for a tenner.
Well, it is a cheaper standard of living in Wigan, there's no question about that.
Yeah, absolutely.
I had no idea of the extent of it.
When I come down to London, you're paying top dollar for everything. Come up here, and it's like, that wasn't an invite to people who...
Well, whether it was or not, I refuse.
You know, the M6 is blocked off, you know? I don't want other people to find my happiness.
But and your happiness? Oh, I have something just appropriate for it. Happiness, happiness. Of course, he used to come from Wigan.
Pardon?
That's where Ken Dodd came from, Wigan. Or at least his dog did. Did you know that Ken Dodd's dad's dog's dead?
No, he comes from Knotty Ash, which is in Liverpool.
Liverpool, yeah, I know, that's correct.
At the M58, yeah? Yeah.
But when you... Right, so you come down to London, you can't afford anything, you go back up to Wigan, and the cost of living is so much cheaper. The problem is, whatever you buy in Wigan, you're still in Wigan.
Yes.
Yeah.
But we've got a good football team.
You do?
Yes, but I still support Arsenal.
Right. So you're a bit I guess you haven't heard the news.
Listen, I'm not even going to discuss that with you.
You're not even going to go there, girlfriend?
I was listening to... Pardon?
Carry on.
What did you say? Do I have a girlfriend?
No, I said, you're not even going to go there, girlfriend. I came over all Oprah Winfrey for a second.
I thought you said, have you got a girlfriend?
No, that would be completely inappropriate for me to say that.
No, I haven't got a girlfriend.
Right.
I've been kidnapped by a woman from this area and been took up here.
And yes, how's that going with you?
I have three kids, I do apologise.
You got the Stockholm syndrome yet?
Well, it's, I don't go out syndrome. No, on a serious note now, you know what you were talking about then before, conspiracy theories and stuff like that?
Yeah.
I've watched, a couple of films lately, right, and as I said to the guy who took my call and rung me back, I'm not gonna be, like, detrimental to any religion or any, you know, I
have no. Here we go.
No. Here we go not. Right? I watched Fahrenheit 9/11. Yeah?
Yes.
And then I watched another one, In Plain Sight.
In Plain Sight?
In Plain Sight, a documentary.
Right.
I don't know whether you're familiar with that or not.
No. Is it like, Loose Change? One of these conspiracy theorist things that, America actually blew up.
Well, I don't know what Loose Change is, so I can't, say that. Sorry if that's a pun or whatever, I don't
know. No, it isn't. No, it isn't.
But, this...
It's a conspiracy theory, movie that basically...
It was quite... I watched it and, I mean, I've studied psychology, sociology, etc., and I've...
All the useless subjects, yeah.
Pardon?
I did a degree in psychology, and useful in any shape or form.
Yeah, I've done psychology, sociology, looked at these, and it was someone else saying to me, look at this. And when I've watched it, there's a big question mark above my DVD player.
Right, there's a big question mark above my head right now, because I've got no idea what you're talking about, I'm afraid, Matt.
Oh, cheers.
Anyway, I'm just being honest.
All right, no, but I've watched... You know, Fahrenheit 9/11, the other ones that come out, and,
yeah.
You know, and this, that, and the other, and there's another one there that I've watched, and, for want of better words, I apologise.
Oh, no.
I'm in awe.
Oh, no.
No, I'm not going to swear. I'm in awe of what I've watched, because I'm like, You know, and I don't know whether it's been tampered, you know, people can play about on the media, on the computer, and do this, do that, and do the other. But I sat and watched it, and I've watched it as, you know, Joe Bloggs, and I'm quite confused by it.
Yeah, me too. I'm mystified. I've got no idea what's going on my own show. But anyway, Matt, as soon as you get it straightened out in your mind, you put it down on a piece of paper and send it to me. All right.
I'll tell you what. Will you do me a favour?
Right.
Just come off air for a minute, please.
Can I come off air?
Yeah, come
no,
up
mate,
there.
No, mate, I'm busy, doing a show.
No, I know. Well, come off there and let me speak to your answer phone fella.
Yeah? He's very upset that you were calling that. He's not a machine.
Well, what's his name?
He's a real man.
Yeah, I know it's a real man.
Listen, I'll tell you what, Matt, but it's been a pleasure, but you're mystifying me now.
Right,
you're,
okay, then what's your man? You know the guy that answers
phone? Yeah, answer machine, yeah.
No, not your answer machine. What's his name?
What's his name? I don't know if he wants me to reveal that information.
All right, then we'll call him A.
A, yeah. Yeah. All right, we'll call him A something.
Well, no. That's entirely up to you what you want to call him.
But listen, Matt, I really do have to go, but it's been mystifying. Right. All right.
Would you just put me back to him, because I can talk to him for a second, and I will send you this, and you can watch it, yeah?
Just give me the name of it, and I'll look it up on the pewter.
Okay, it's called In Plain Sight.
In Plain Sight. Got it. Memorised it. And we'll definitely be looking it up this week. All right, thanks a lot, Matt.
All right, cheers.
Ta-da, mate. Right. Ads at 29:05. Do we want to take the ads now or later? No! Oh, my God, the look of desperation in your face. Of course we don't want to take them now. Follow the instructions on the screen, you moron. Is that what you're saying? Hello, Joan.
Hello.
Joan.
Yes!
Hello, Joan.
You went a bit faint there.
I'm getting Fanta. There we are, back at Derek and Clive. Only like six people in this audience know what I just meant by that, but anyway, carry on. Joan.
No, you're talking about Iran, and where everybody's supposed to be getting really, really worried about Iran.
Well, the leader of Iran...
It might have a nuclear bomb. Oh, gosh, it might just be making one.
The leader of Iran is called I'm Mad in the Head.
Yes, but who's madder? Who's worse? Who's fantastically worse? The Americans in the first attack on Baghdad in 2003 dropped the equivalent of seven times the bomb that they dropped on Hiroshima in one day. And nobody goes berserk about this.
Wow, you really have brought this show to a crashing halt. Thanks a lot, Joan.
No, really. I mean, seriously, if you're going to worry about Iran...
No, I do worry,
about America?
Well, America isn't pointing its guns at us.
Well, it would be if we said no to America.
That's all it would take?
No!
Yeah, just a nice big... No, we're not going to do it, America.
Like a big fat... No!
No!
Yeah, I seriously doubt they'd bomb us. Haven't you heard about our special relationship?
Yeah, that means you do what I tell you.
Yeah, I know.
Or else.
Yeah. It's right. It's like a parent's special relationship with their child.
Yes.
Yeah, do what
only
I tell
worse,
you.
Only worse.
Do what I tell you or I'll slap your legs. And the child will say, well, I'll sue you.
You know, I don't think people know this. And why did they even have to do it? You know, the country was flat on its back anyway. There was nothing left. Why did they do that to civilians?
You're persisting in trying to drag this show to a crashing crashing halt, aren't you,
Joe? I just want to get people to know and instead of us all
I'd rather walk around in a state of blissful ignorance. So what have you done today, Joan? Yeah, he said, desperately trying to change the subject.
All right, because it's every quarter of an hour we hear the news, you know.
Every quarter of an hour,
And so even if you're bright and cheery. We still have to hear this blooming news about Iran.
I know, I'm sandwiched I'm the filling in death and disaster, and I'm trying to be cheerful here, and you're sullying the filling, Joan.
Well, I'm not.
So what have you been doing today?
I can't remember. Let me think.
remember. Oh, no.
I don't think I did an awful lot, actually.
I feel your pain. I can't remember either.
No, it was all right. It was all right.
It wasn't bad. Sunday could be better, then,
It was just too rainy for me to be bothered, really.
I know. I think yesterday was the last day of summer. Wasn't it lovely?
Another thing.
And another thing.
Yeah, I mean, I've just got to mention a few other things. Did you know, or have you asked yourself...
Is this going to depress me as well?
Well...
Is that a yes?
You know, when we get our weather forecast these days...
Yes.
And they say, oh, it's sort of like 22 up Sutton High Street, or it's 15 up in Notting Hill, or it's 36. Mm.
They know exactly what they're talking about, and they're completely correct in that respect.
And you say, what about, you know, somebody's back kitchen?
Yes.
In the front garden,
correct.
In the back garden,
mm-hmm.
in
all
the
of
sun,
those places.
In the shade.
Yeah, you're right.
It used to always be in the shade.
Absolutely accurate at all times. We guarantee it.
Radio Riders.
Hey, Paul Ross is on tomorrow. He is a giant brain, is Paul Ross. He's going to be on tomorrow from 7 in the morning, and he will be playing a song that contains either the words trapped or burn in it. I was trying to think of songs that have trapped or burn. I can't think of any song that's got trapped in it. Can you think of a song that's got trapped in it, boys?
Colonel Abraham's Trap?
Yes.
Never heard of it. Colonel Abraham's Trapped? How does that go?
I'm not going to sing
it. Oh, go on.
I'm not Lucy. What was the other one? Burnt.
Burn. Now, I've got, Burn Baby Burn. Yeah.
Burning Down the House.
Burning Down the House. Huh? Disco, but that's not Burn, though.
What do you mean the
Oh, Burn Baby Burn, Disco Inferno, that's correct, yeah. Yeah. Burning Down the House, and then I'm running out.
Crash and Burn.
That's not a song, is it?
It probably
Manic
is.
Street no.
That's this show.
That's Slash and Burn.
Slash and Burn. Manic Street Preachers.
Well, he's not going to play the Manics, is he?
We'll be back. Okay.
I think he's much more likely to play the Talking Heads than the Manics.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right.
Anyway, he's going to be playing a song which has got the words trapped or burn in it, and then get on the phone, rush to it, and call him to win the ultimate day for pampering and relaxation, which sounds lovely. A facial, a manicure, a range of treatments at one of Champney's luxury spas. And do they have the thing where they cover you in mud and then turn the hose on you? Because that always sounded invigorating to me. This is all with Bisodol, indigestion relief tablets with the triple action formula to release trapped wind and heartburn. Always read the label with Paul Ross tomorrow at 7. 7 onwards. Hey, Dermot.
Hello, Nick. Hi.
How are you?
Not too bad. But I'm just here to put a hole in your theory about the moon landing.
A hole in my bucket.
Absolutely. You know, kind of, okay, one of the, a striking reason why, you know, kind of, it's not contrived or whatever, the whole moon landing, or it wasn't faked, is because we were in the middle of a Cold War. There was a moon race. And do you think for one second that the Kremlin, Chinese at that, would have allowed the Americans to take, you know, to grab that prize? You know, if there was any hint of some kind of goings on, whatever, you know, they would have been jumping up and down saying, look, it's, no, it's all a fake, da-da-da-da-da.
Yeah, we wouldn't have been able to understand a word they say, because they're foreign.
Damn it, you've beaten my... Damn it, you've shot me down.
There's a hole in your bucket, dear Liza, dear Liza.
I'll give you another thing. All the TV stations had all their radar, had all their signals pointing up to this moon place, and they were following this craft the whole way up, and it seemed to land up in the moon.
And, yeah, but we didn't see that from cameras on Earth.
Granted, yes, but the you know, we saw the guys going into this rocket, which was tracked by the technology. Okay, damn it,
your whole argument's falling apart here, Dermot. I've got one question.
The technology wasn't as good then.
One question.
Yeah.
Who was taking the pictures of the first man on the moon?
Don't know. Honestly, I haven't a clue.
Right, well, yeah, see, that's a basic question, isn't it? I mean, they didn't have a camera on an arm, did they? Because it wouldn't have survived the landing or the taking off or, you know, whatever it is. Well, who was the cameraman that was taking the picture of the first man to step onto the moon?
It was Buzz, wasn't it?
It was a remote control camera that was activated by movement.
Yes, but if it was the first man on the moon, then... there was no one there on the moon to take the pictures of the man stepping onto the moon.
God, all my theories shot down and flamed. Absolutely disgraceful. But anyway, no, this whole business about conspiracy theories anyway, I think it's just, in many cases, it's just simply people who are not prepared to maybe accept the reality of a situation.
Yeah, either that, or they don't want to accept the wool being pulled over their eyes. You know where they get wool from, don't you? That's right.
I suppose.
You accept that, do you?
But in real terms, you know, it's... No, I do find it a bit discouraging that there's constant re-examination of maybe just basic facts.
Oh, it just adds to the gaiety of life, doesn't it? Relax, man. Enjoy it.
And we are in the silly season, so...
Yeah, we are. Soon to come to a crashing halt.
Absolutely, yeah.
All right, thanks a lot, Dermot.
Bye.
Ta-ta. So the GCSEs are out. The GCSEs, they're the ones that are easier than the A-levels, right? Have I got that right? Because I did Scottish exams, and they were highers and O-grades. That was back when they actually taught you things in school, rather than just, you know, when to show up and how to write your name. Triple A+. The A-levels came out, and everyone who spelled their name right got an A, meaning that the results were completely meaningless. So the A-levels were the difficult ones, and the GCSEs were the easier ones, which makes it curious why the A-level results came out first, because they would have been harder to mark. But let's just leave that, you know, hanging in the air. The A-level pass rate has risen for the 24th year in succession. I mean, just that figure alone should make you suspicious. I mean, talk about conspiracy theories. The proportion of entries graded A was 24%. Like a quarter. A quarter of the people who enter an exam, the hardest exam that we got for school leavers, got an A. So that means that an A is really a B at best. Because an A should be the top 10% or 5%, right? It should be the actual cream, not just anybody who happens to show up. The reduction in the amount of content candidates had to master for mathematics revived interest in the subject and led to an increase in entries of 5.8 percentage points. In other words, they made it easier, and so people got more interested. And they came out with an examination result that made it look like they knew something, but actually they didn't, because the exam was easier. Overall, the pass rate was 96%. It's impossible to fail. I mean, you'd have to not show up to fail this exam. 96% passed. That's just ridiculous. Surely 50% should be the pass rate, right? But we don't want anybody to feel that they've failed, which is why they banned sports days, because there'll only be one winner. So they've banned it. so as not to abuse children's human rights, to feel like they're always winners. Well, you know what? In society, there aren't always winners. A lot of people become losers, too, a lot of the time, no fault of their own. But that's the fact, Jack, and as soon as you go out into the real world outside school and university, then you find that that's actually true. And sometimes there's no rhyme or reason to it. Life ain't fair. But if you're led through school to believe that anything you do is just super, thanks for asking, then it's not going to prepare you for the grim reality of life outside, right? Right?
I hated sports day.
Yeah, me too. Well, I didn't do sports at all. When I went to my the school that I went to in Scotland, I decided at a very early point not to go to any sports at all.
Surely it's too cold to do sports in Scotland.
Yes, mostly. And, and plus the sports, I was not remotely... Until they put skiing on the menu, which I was fully up for, and I went to all of the skiing. But until they did that, it was rugby and cricket, neither of which I had a moment's time for. And I went to the cafe around the corner and sat in the basement and smoked cigarettes and pretended I was hard with all the other lads. And we would listen to Play That Funky Music, White Boy, by Wild Cherry and David Bowie. And we'd, compare punk records that we bought that day. And it got to the point that I could never actually show up for sports anymore because they wouldn't know who I was. So I dug myself into a corner there, and it was a comfortable one.
Hmm, sounds good.
We'd sit there for about 4 hours drinking one cup of coffee. Oh, we were really popular. Yeah, we were the only people in there. We fed the jukebox, all right. £100,000 we put in that jukebox. All the money that we were supposed to spend on food. A bag of chips with brown sauce on them. Have you ever had chips in Scotland? It's not vinegar and salt. In fact, I think it's an Edinburgh thing, because Glasgow has their own thing. It's like watered-down brown sauce, which, of course, makes your hands stickier than you could ever imagine. And you'd wipe it on your school blazer. Of course you would.
I've got a friend that lives in Edinburgh.
You're very distant.
Sorry. I've got a friend that lives in Edinburgh, and she came back to London and couldn't believe they didn't have chips and sauce.
In Edinburgh?
Yeah, no, she came back to London.
Oh, she came to London, they couldn't...
They didn't have
chips
and
sauce. Yeah, you have to provide your own sauce, by which you buy HP sauce and then water it down with... Well, I've got absolutely no idea. Probably the stuff that they pickle eggs in. The leftover detritus from the pickled egg jar. Did anybody ever have one of those? I would eat a pickled egg straight after eating a saveloy, which is to say, never. Anyway, where was I? Oh, yes. The A grades. And then the GCSEs. The GCSEs have come even closer this year to attaining the status of an examination that is impossible to fail. The pass rate rose to, guess what, 98.1%. Can you imagine being a person who would fail an exam that over 98% of the people who sat it passed? I mean, how deeply embarrassing would that be?
Does that mean the pass grade, though? That's not A to C, though, is it? That could be like a G grade.
Can you get a G grade?
Or F.
Or a Z.
Z.
I think they just throw grades at you just to make everyone a winner in Tony Blair land. Where everyone just, like, dances around like a Teletubby and everything's super.
It's an EU ruling, isn't it?
I don't think we can drag the EU into this.
The N grade the best. N for nearly.
The proportion of exams awarded at least a grade C, which in my E, it were grand when I were a lad. In my day, when you sat an exam and you got 49%, you failed. These days, that's a stunning success. Top A and A star grades were awarded to 20% of the people that sat the exams. That is just absolutely shocking. Examiners denied that it was becoming easier to pass, insisting that the standard had been maintained over time. Anybody believe that? It said more pupils were taking courses that matched their abilities. That's the reason that they're passing in such huge numbers. In other words, the exams have been reduced to match the abilities of the people that are sitting them in order to make government targets seem achievable and a good thing. Head teachers admitted that schools were putting pupils in for easier subjects such as religious studies, media studies and citizenship to increase their positions in the league tables. What's citizenship? What is that? It's like, don't enter a home unless you've been invited. Say please and thank you. Hold a door open for a lady. What is that? Have you got any idea? I'm mystified. Say yes or no.
I'm scratching my head.
Metaphorically. The biggest increase in entries was seen for courses in statistics, media, film and television studies, business and communication systems, and religious studies. Right, in other words, all the subjects that won't actually equip you to do anything. Media studies. That's just like watching Coronation Street, isn't it?
I've got a media studies A-level.
Do you?
Yeah.
And what did it involve? Exactly.
We watched Apocalypse Now. That was quite good.
Charlie, don't surf.
Yeah.
Remember that.
Mm-hmm.
Candidates can achieve a pass in... Physical education is another thing that people are taking because it's easy. This is one of the reasons that the pass rate's up so much, is they've got all these Mickey Mouse... I'm sorry, Disney will be furious. They've got all these joke courses that people go on because it'll give them another A. You can achieve a pass in physical education, for example, with 18 out of 80 correct on a written paper. That's just staggering,
isn't
it?
They're doing PE, though. They're lucky to be able to write, some of them.
In business studies, candidates can get a grade G if they can, for example, describe a retailer. Here's the question on the exam. What is a retailer? Is it a shop? Yes. Correct. You pass. It's just incredible, isn't it? No, they haven't been dumbed down. Of course not. That would never happen. Hello, Philip.
Good evening, Nick. Couple of things I'd like to talk to you about this evening.
It's Mr. List.
Oh, well, no, not really. Live shows. I remember in the late 50s...
Live shows?
You're talking about going to see live shows.
Oh, not those kind of live shows. Oh. Right, I'm with you.
And in the 50s and 60s, there was a guy called... You heard of Larry Parnes?
No.
Well, Larry Parnes was a sort of... like Brian Epstein, he had lots of groups under his supervision. And they all had fantastic names. Johnny Gentle...
Here's a list.
Duffy Power, Dickie Pride, Vince Eager, Marty Wilde, who's still around today, and Tommy Steele. And he used to send them out in a package. And you'd go, I saw them at the Granada in Sutton, which is now an office block. And they used to occasionally have the odd American star on, and the one I went to, they had Gene Vincent. And they'd all put on a show, and, oh yes, and Screaming Lord Sutch.
Right, so he would fit in those crazy names. Yeah. Gene Vincent sounds a bit too normal. Of course, yeah. He wasn't.
But... Well, no, he wasn't, not with all the leather and these bebopalula, you know, it was very good.
He was good.
He was good. I mean, Tommy Steele, I mean, I was reading an article about him today in the paper.
Let's not bring Tommy Steele into it, please.
Rock with a Caveman. That was one of his, that was his first song. And then Marty Wilde, End of Sleep. And it was a great show, you know, and you see these stars, and you'd have a marvellous time.
Well,
I think it was the first concert I ever saw. And then I was in Nashville, and I went to Opryland, the theme park. I don't believe it's there anymore, and saw this amazing blind pianist. Have you ever heard of a guy called Ronnie Millsap?
No.
And he fantastic. You know, he's a real, you know. Great performer, you know, really on the piano. I saw a live performance with him. And then I saw a guy who's still around today, a great rock and roll legend from the 60s, Freddie Cannon.
Right.
You've heard of Freddie Cannon?
Vaguely,
Have
yes.
A Faith Park.
I know his Cannon, yes.
Yeah, great show. I mean, I think he's about 66, but he still, you know, still rocks with the best of them.
Well, so does Mick Jagger.
Oh, yeah, well, yes. I the only time I saw the Rolling Stones... They performed without instruments.
What?
Yep. I used to go to a radio show, Nick, in Lower Regent Street.
In the Parish Theatre?
Yes. And it was called Pop In. It was in the 60s.
Did you?
Yeah, and all the... Yeah, I was popped in regularly, nearly every week if I could get tickets. And they used to have all the big stars there. And one week, they had the Rolling Stones come up.
You popped in, had a peek, and popped out again.
Oh, no. It was an hour show. And they had the Rolling Stones on, and they were interviewed by the compere, Keith Fordyce... who later went on to do Ready, Steady, Go. And they had to perform, you know, well, not perform, but they played their latest record. So what they did, while it was being played, they stood there making out they got all their instruments with them and miming to the record without their instruments.
What, air guitars?
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
Jagger. Of course it was on radio, so you couldn't tell.
Yeah, that's right. Brian Jones, of course. And it was, as I say, it was a, some, they had a, quite a few stars that appeared there over the period of the concert. But, yeah, it was, what's the best concert you've ever seen?
Oh, blimey, that's a question and a half. I'd have to say that the first concert I ever saw was amazing. He's dead now. The Sensational Alex Harvey Band.
I've heard of Alex Harvey.
One of the greatest showmen ever. Mm-hmm. The Who was fantastic. I saw him a week later at Celtic Park.
Right.
The Pink Floyd, of course, put on an amazing show.
Yes.
Ian Dury was one of the best live acts I've ever seen.
Yeah.
I could go on and on, but
yeah,
I won't.
Yeah. I mean, that is the thing. Some shows you go and see and you feel as though you've been cheated. But, as I say, the ones you mentioned, and it's really, really good. Notting Hill. I was there about 8 years ago working. I used to work on the buses, and I was sent up there to...
Hold tight. Ding, ding.
Yeah, bus diversions. So I had to sort of make sure the buses were turning in the right roads and not going down and joining the... displays and the floats and everything, and it was the noise. It was just the pure noise of the whistles and everything else, and it was certainly an interesting experience. You know, I don't know what went on at the actual thing itself. I did have at the end when the people were coming home, I was standing by this bus stop, and it was my job to supervise it. And I turned around, there's about 50 people waiting for a bus. Now we weren't sure whether we were going to get any or not, so I said, "Well, if you walk 200 yards down the road," I said, "there's an underground station." So I turn round, the next minute they've all gone. And I did this about six times.
Well, you obviously had the voice of authority.
Well, I reckon I cleared about 800 people, three or 400 people that night, going down the road. Anyway, finally, Nick, finally you're going to love this one.
And
Nick,
in closing, I doubt it.
You're,
go on.
You're going to like, yes. You know, I told you the other week about this shop that's closing down and they're selling records off.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I went down there today and they have got an amazing bargain, 15 singles for £1.
Right, I bet they're all rubbish.
Well, I bought three. And if you don't want to buy 15, you can buy them for 20p each.
Right, here comes another list.
Oh, one of them is just up your street. It's Scottish. It's a double-sided hit. It's The Scottish Soldier by Andy Stewart.
Sounds awful.
And on the other side is... Can you guess what's on the other side?
Hootsman Och the Noo or something.
No, Donald, Where's Your Trousers?
Where's Your Trousers?
Yeah, which is pretty good.
That's been hanging around his leg like an albatross ever since he made
it. And the other one was a Mike Oldfield song, which I quite like, which is why I bought it.
That Portsmouth. Hippie. Which one?
Portsmouth.
Portsmouth?
Yeah.
Anybody remember that?
Good song. And then, the classic. Have you ever heard Frank Sinatra singing Winchester Cathedral?
No.
Oh, dear.
He doesn't even know where Winchester is.
Well, no. It's an EP. And what it's got on it is Frank and Nancy. And you've got Something Stupid. They did that together, didn't they?
Yeah, Something Stupid like that, yeah.
And then Winchester Cathedral, Sugartown and Coasting. So, I mean, I've got three good bargains there, haven't I?
Well, no. But did they have anything by Des O'Connor?
No, I didn't see anything by Des O'Connor. They had Shaking Stevens. Kylie Minogue, they had some in there.
In the bargain bin, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you want to pop down there, Nick. I mean, what a bargain. 15 for a pound.
15 pieces of rubbish that you'd never play at all, ever, for a quid, yeah.
And they got some LPs.
You're really selling it to me. But no, Des, I can't believe it.
What?
We're going to be right back.
People of Britain.
Oh, Charlie.
Hi.
Hey, Charlie.
Good. Self.
Do you surf?
Do I surf?
Surf.
Only surf the web. I don't
right.
surf.
Charlie does surf. I was wrong about that.
No. No, I just had two very small little issues. The one was about your conspiracy theories, and the other one about the lady that said they dropped a bomb in, I think it was Hiroshima or something like that.
God, here we go. Down, down, down.
Don't worry. Well, the Hiroshima one was nobody asked them to blow up Pearl Harbor, first of all. The second part, which is the conspiracy theory, is it not actually the government themselves creating the conspiracy theory to throw people off the track?
well, in other words, to make us concentrate on a lot of insignificant stuff while they're really getting away with murder behind our backs.
Exactly.
Right. My guess is yes.
I'm pretty sure that's the case, i.e. all these aliens, UFOs, that kind of thing. If you look up on the internet, that kind of, and if they actually say there is no such thing as UFOs, aliens. Yes, there is unidentified flying objects that we don't know about because it's actually a new designed aircraft by different governments or something like
that. Yeah, quite possibly.
But those were my minor points. I'm not very good at doing this, so...
Well, anyway. you've got them across well. Thanks a lot, Charlie.
Ta.
Ta-ta. Cheers. Let's go with Philip in South Norwood again. I've just spoken to him. I don't want to talk to him again. I mean, he's a nice bloke, but next week then, eh? Hmm? What? Break. Always say it on the air, or I won't... In fact, I'm not going to do it until you say it on the air.
Break.
Break. Break, he says. Off you go.
RAC patrolman Paul Maven. Hello?
Hey, Steve. Oh, Steve.
Hey, Nick. How are you?
I'm all right, mate.
Oh, right. Anyway, the reason I phoned, people talking about Apollo missions to the moon and the like.
Yes.
Right in front of me right now, I've got Buzz Aldrin's doctoral thesis, and it's about space missions to the moon.
His doctoral thesis?
Yep, he's a doctor. He's a professor at MIT.
Dr. Buzz?
Yep, Dr. Buzz.
Okay.
Same one, because you know Neil Armstrong's completely loopy, because I think you said it, because I've heard it before, that he believes you only have a certain number of heartbeats like animals do, so you've got to keep yourself calm to stay alive longer.
Well, there's probably a lot to be said for that.
I'm in trouble there. My heart's rather fast. But anyway, what's it called, right? So, a bit quick, it's not, because people are not into this stuff, not might find it very interesting. His doctoral thesis was called Line of Sight Guidance Techniques for Manned Orbital Rendezvous. He wrote it in 1963, and basically what it means is, what does that mean, 6 years before that she got to the moon, he was writing about how to, a spaceship will get down to the moon, get back up and reunite with the command module. Because, you know, when they land on the moon, you had a thing called the Eagle, which was what him and Armstrong actually landed in. You also have a thing called a command module, which was the third astronaut, Michael Collins, remained in space.
The mothership.
Yeah, the mothership, exactly. Leave the mothership, come down to surface, go back to mothership. And so 6 years beforehand, he actually wrote the means of the mothership reconnection. So when people say it's all conspiracy, well, he gave it to them 6 years early about how to do it. It's all here, 300, over 300 pages of it. A lot of maths, that's a bit difficult, but...
But what's your point, Steve?
My point is that when people say, oh, it was all conspiracy, well, he actually provided, I've got in front of me the means of doing it 6 years beforehand, for the landing and returning, so... That solves all the problems. When people say it can't be done, well, I've got it here in front of me.
Why do you have it there in front of you? That seems like a strange thing to have in front of you.
No, because, I did chemistry, moved into rocket science after chemistry. Although I worked as an astronaut, bizarrely enough. But,
oh, no! There's another one we've lost. You did chemistry, you've got a degree in chemistry, and you're an actor?
Yeah, because it's a lot easier, more fun. But, when I got some money together... It depends on what work I'm getting. It's not much, if things are a bit quiet, it's concentrate on the science studies. When the work's more busy, get over acting work or journalist work. When it goes a bit quiet, back on the sciences. That's how it works.
And how is business?
Not good. Well, we did a film. Film's been released, but we got, you know, we've had the premiere, but we never wait to get the distribution deal, so it's like half released. So they've done another film. I'm supposed to be the voice of a demon for a film. That's, as far as I know, it's on hold. I'm going to reply back about
the
that.
The voice for what?
Oh, you know, some films have demons in them.
Oh, demons! Right.
Oh, yeah. So
you actually missed that. You actually missed that question entirely. When someone in the business is asked, "How's business?" You're supposed to say, "It's like no business." I know.
There's no business like show business, like no business I know.
Everything about it is appealing. Always remember that, Steve. Cheers, mate.
Next time.
Ta-da. This is LBC 97.3. Everything about it is appealing. Can anybody think of a single thing that's wrong with show business? Oh, blimey. Let's make a list. We'll get Philip of Norwood. He'll have a pen and paper ready. Where do you even start? Well, there's the money, there's the lack of pension, lack of any security whatsoever.
On FM, on DAB, and Abbott.
Well, let's get back to it.
Sir Cliff Richard disclosed yesterday that he invited Tony Blair to spend a holiday at his home in Barbados because the Prime Minister seemed dwindled and haggard. That's not very nice, is it? The singer said he'd simply wanted to do a good deed for someone who had to do a terrible job. Not for someone who was doing a terrible job. He was quite specific about the way he put that. Sir Cliff, 65. He must be about the same age as Mick Jagger, right? Because Mick Jagger, you must be 60-something. And I'll tell you what, I'd rather sit in front of... I'd rather pay 150 quid to see Mick Jagger than Cliff Richard. How about you?
Yeah.
Sir Cliff. Why do we always have to insist on calling him Sir, by the way? Anyone that's got a title in front of their name, we're doffing our cap and bowing and scraping. What a silly country this is. Well, I think we're the only country in the world that does this, aren't we? I mean, do they call me Mr. Nick? No! Anyway, Sir Cliff, 65, also disclosed that he had first got to know the Blairs after, get this, after Cherie Blair contacted him looking for free tickets to one of his concerts. Actually, he doesn't earn enough to buy the tickets. I mean, I earn nothing at all, so me scraping some free Stones tickets, that's perfectly acceptable, because it would have cost £300 for two, which is just incredible, isn't it? But Cherie Blair, what does she want free tickets for? Anyway, the family's returned to Barbados in each of the past three summers, after Cliff said, come over here and check out my house. Which seems, I don't know, maybe Sir Cliff's happy with that, but if you said to somebody, you know, on your holidays, you can come stay at my place, and they then went back every summer for 3 years running, you'd think, oh, it's taking the mick a bit here, aren't they?
It is the Prime Minister.
Well, I know, but does he pay for it? Does he even chip in? Does he leave a tip for the staff? Anything like that?
Maybe he leaves a few quid for bills and stuff.
Sure he does. Cliff says, our relationship has not bloomed into a close friendship yet. I would not think of calling Tony up. Now, that's just plain weird. Would you invite somebody to stay in your house 3 years running that you didn't feel confident of calling them up? I mean, he's saying, on the one hand, that they're perfectly welcome to come and stay, but he doesn't know them very well. Huh? You making any sense of this? That's just nuts, isn't it?
Weird.
Weird is the word. Sir Cliff angrily dismissed suggestions that he had used the relationship to promote his copyright campaign. This copyright campaign is because I think the copyright on his songs runs out after 50 years, right? And, of course, he's so gigantically old that he's about to start ceasing to earn money from the hits that he had in the early 1600s. And so he wants it extended. And Tony Blair seems to be very au fait with that. In fact, he seems to be treating it as with some degree of urgency, which is, you know, nice that he's got the time to do that. But what with all the other... storm of crap that's surrounding him, he actually has time to think about, you know, multimillionaires earning more money. Well, you know, he's doing a tremendous job. But Sir Cliff angrily dismissed suggestions that he'd use the relationship to promote his campaign. How dare people suggest I asked him to help me or spoke to anyone else, he says. My very raison d'etre is not to do anything like that. See, that's why they call him Sir, because he can slip into French every now and again. Why would you say raison d'être? I mean, you might write it down, but you wouldn't say it, surely, would you? My very reason to be, you'd say. Or you just wouldn't even embark on such a ridiculous sentence in the first place. He must have, this is Cliff again, he must have great difficulty in the same way people like myself do in finding friends who want you for yourself. Oh, no. There's some music to come with this. Cliff finds it hard to find people who want Cliff just for Cliff. And not for his gigantic house. So I wanted Cherie and Tony to think they're friends of ours. They need never ask us for anything. Apart from the house. Every summer. For 3 years. Sir Cliff also revealed that he could not sleep for four nights after reports that he had told Gordon Ramsay, the chef, to bleep off while appearing on Ramsay's The F Word program on Channel 4. Did he actually say that?
Isn't it required on that show? Even if you are Cliff.
The singer denied swearing at the chef, though he has said he did swear once for him after Ramsay had asked him to use the F word. All these years and I'm still vulnerable. Things still hurt, he said. Oh dear. I'm gonna throw up. So he's lonely. Oh. All he needs is the company of a good woman.
Yeah.
I'm amazed he hasn't found one yet. Let's go with Glenn in Chingford. Oh, Glenn.
Hello, Nick.
Yes, Glenn.
I would like to change the subject slightly.
Go ahead.
I've been thinking that there seems to be a lot of angry people walking about the streets of London nowadays. What do you think?
I think that the country's gone crazy.
Yeah, it's just that it seems. Sorry about the noise. I'm in the kitchen.
He's just taking out the empties.
Yeah,
well, booze.
It seems that people are more friendly. You know, sort of 20 years ago. I mean, I'm only coming up to 40 now, but only 20 years ago, it seems people more friendly towards each other. But now it seems that people are a lot more suspicious of each other.
Well, if you look at somebody wrong, then you'll get stabbed in the face. Yeah, and there's good reason to be more suspicious.
Yeah, exactly. I just want to know what sort of London thinks about that sort of thing, whether I'm just on my own or...
Well, I know what I feel about it. I don't know about London, but I know what I feel about it. And I do, like I said this last week, and I do find it surprising where I go to work, I go into town and then out of it again without being killed. I just find it surprising every time it happens.
Exactly, yeah. It just seems so much more dangerous to go into London nowadays than it used to be, for me.
And it's not just over the last 10 years or so. It seems to be over the last couple of months.
Yeah, actually, I quite agree with that. Yeah, I do agree with that.
People have gone completely insane.
Yeah, you do hear more stories of violence and guns and, you know, in London.
And it's not just that the press has got one of their, like, dangerous dog stories, you know, because if a child gets bit by a dangerous dog, then the whole of the press is looking for a similar story. And although it happens all the time, it don't get reported all the time.
Yeah.
But it'll just be, like, flavour of the week. So it's not that, because it would make the news if someone was shot in the streets of London, regardless of whether it was fashionable this month to talk about it. But it just seems to be happening a lot. I mean,
that's right, yeah.
When was the last time that people just got shot? I mean, this is incredible to me.
Yeah, I agree, yeah. You know, it used to be years ago, if somebody got murdered, it would be all in the papers. But now it seems like an everyday occurrence, and it's just worrying, I think. You know?
I mean, the local news now is recent deaths in your area.
Exactly, yeah.
Followed by an inaccurate weather report.
Yeah, I think the world's gone crazy, to be honest.
It has.
Yeah. Wonder what.
Totally loopy. Every time you leave your house, you don't want to look at anybody. In fact, don't make eye contact with anyone at all. Because
that's right.
The entire world has gone crazy.
Exactly. I just wanted to know what London thought of it, you know, whether I'm alone in what I think or whether it's just an ongoing problem.
No, let me speak for London as one, because what we think of it basically can be put into a word of one syllable. That's what we think of it.
Definitely, Nick, definitely.
All right, thanks a lot, Glenn.
Thank you.
Cheers,
thanks,
mate.
Nick, bye.
Ta-ra. Let's go with Peter in Golders Green. Hang on, I'm going to get into we're going to take a pause, and then we'll get into the papers. They've all arrived, and I'll figure out what's in them in a moment. Oh, Peter.
Hi, how are you?
I'm all right, thanks.
Yeah, what's happening?
Oh, you know, just doing a show.
I tell you what, I ran the Vauban Club in Kingsley Street from 1970 for Lewis Brown.
The what club?
The Vauban in Kingsley Street.
Spell it?
The Vauban Club.
Spell it?
Yeah, Vauban.
Vauban.
Vauban Club in Kingsley Street. Well, everybody knows the Vauban.
Oh, everybody knows the Vauban.
No.
We had Annabelle's and Tramps and the Vauban.
Right. Well, I'm not of that ilk.
Yeah, not. But the first band I put on, because I came from a little village in Wales to take over the Vauban, and the first band I put on live was Bill Haley and the Comets.
Right. When was that?
Well, 1970, sir.
He was still alive.
I still were.
No, not
and
you.
And then the Detour Emeralds, you know, the Drifters, Diana Ross and the Supremes. All these people must be knowing about the Vauban in Kingsley Street. It was next to Miranda's, behind Hamley's Toy Store. You know Regent Street?
Oh, Kingsley Street. Yeah, yeah, I know. It's an alleyway.
Yeah, a little alleyway where you walk through.
And everyone used to relieve themselves after a night out.
On that alleyway.
Yeah.
But the Vauban was the creme de la creme. It was all done out like a Polynesian village, you know.
Creme de la creme? I seriously doubt that.
And it was at a 100-seater restaurant with a swimming pool. Everybody was there. Diana Dawes, everybody was down there, you know. And it was so wonderful in those days, you know.
Right.
And it's such a long time ago, and I hope that people are listening to me, Peter Lewis, that they remember me, because that was fantastic in those days down there, you know.
Oh, it's Peter Lewis from the Vauban Club. Oh, well, you should have said, mate.
Well, but it was a wonderful time, you know. We had Tom Jones down there, we had everybody down there. You know, you talk about people from the past, I'm in Golders Green just doing my thing. But I used to wear the lovely white suits and the Cuban heel boots.
Groovy.
I was the man.
Yeah.
Yowza.
But it was lovely times at the Vauban, you know?
All right, well, you've been, with talk of Diana Dawes, you've been marching us down memory lane.
Well,
thanks a lot, Peter.
Alan Lake and Diana Dawes. My wife and I used to go down there to Bray and have
to lunch Bray
with them when right. She had a big pink Cadillac, you know.
What, like to Bray, like a horse?
But those were good days, you know.
Yeah, sounds like it.
I think was a very special place. Well, I think the people are hearing what we're talking about.
Right. Okay.
Will remember. The Vauban.
Yeah, oh, the Vauban. Oh, well, you should have said right at the beginning. Anyway, listen, thanks a lot, Peter.
Well, you're very welcome.
Cheers, mate. Ta-da.
God bless you and God bless the Vauban.
What club was that again?
Terrorism.
Gun. Bienvenue. Welcome. Come on in.
Right, the paper. What?
Blazing Saddles.
Yes, correct. Absolutely correct, sir.
Have a GCSE.
In media studies.
A grade, please.
Yeah, you got it. Right, the papers, let's have a look. The Observer is just too boring to go through. Who buys it, really? The News of the World. The News of the World is, I don't know, it used to be a fun paper. Do you remember the News of the World used to be a fun paper? Now they seem to have gone down the Daily Mail route, and it's all like death and horror, and it's just not fun anymore. I thought that the News of the World was supposed to be, you know, frivolous, but they got into this whole thing where it's all about, you know, and it's just too depressing on a Sunday. I mean, you have to go through, look at this, one, page three, four, no, five, no, six, no, seven, no, eight. You have to go to page eight before you see any boobs. Isn't that shocking?
Disappointing.
Huh? I'll say
disappointing.
This. Yeah, definitely. And then, it's just all grim. Oh, here we go. I was so drunk, I gave in to sick sex fantasy. Says BB Beauty Imogen. Tells of porn shame with X. That's what we want from the News of the World. A bit of heavy panting. You have to get in a long way into the paper before you get any. Here's the Sunday Telegraph, which says, blunders by NHS kill thousands of patients a year. Isn't that incredible? First audit of deaths and injuries in the health service reveals a toll of more than 500,000 serious incidents. Serious as in life-ruining. Just because they got a uniform on doesn't mean to say they know anything. Get a third opinion, never mind about a second one. The Sunday Times, 10 million want to quit the UK. One in five Britons, that is shocking. One in five Britons, nearly 10 million adults, is considering leaving the country amid new research which suggests that the main political parties are failing to fulfil people's desires for tax cuts. We've been taxed to a standstill. And can anybody think of anything that's got better as the tax has gone up and up and what are they spending their money on? our money on. Sunday Express. Richard Whiteley by the woman he loved. Oh, you've got to be joking. Sinister Hook and a Very Odd School, watched by MI5, Islamic Academy with only 12 pupils and no books. Okay. The Mail, they're upset about something, I bet they are. Spy in your wheelie bin, German microchip bugs secretly installed in 500,000 homes. What? Electronic spy bugs have been secretly planted in hundreds of thousands of household wheelie bins. The gadgets, mostly installed by companies based in Germany, transmit information about the contents of the bins to a central database which then keeps records on the waste disposal habits of each individual address. Are you getting this? Until now, the majority of bins have been altered without the knowledge of their owners. In many cases, councils which ordered the installation of the devices did not even debate the proposals publicly. The official reason for the bugs is to improve efficiency and settle disputes between neighbours over wheelie bin ownership, but experts say the technology is actually intended to enable councils to impose fines on householders who exceed limits on the amount of non-recyclable waste they put out. More fines! New powers for councils to do this are expected to be introduced by the government shortly. OMG! The Sunday Mirror. Heather's new nude shoot. Try saying that 10 times quickly when you're drunk. Heather's new nude shoot. Just 3 weeks ago, she posed naked for Secret Calendar at Macca's house, it says. Her astonishing photo shoot, page 7. Oh, let's have a look at that one. Page 7, you say? Hang on a moment. Nikki and I... This is before we get to page 7. This is by the by. This is a Big Brother moment. Nikki and I put on a girl-on-girl sex show for £800. Oh, is that it? Heather Mills stripped off an amazing erotic calendar shoot at the lodge on her estranged husband's estate. It was just 3 weeks ago when the blah, 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 and so on and so forth. When are they going to get to the court case? When is it going to get to the blood will start flying between Macca and Mucka? And Mucka, I think, is a pretty weak thing. I mean, because the tabloid people have teams of people trying to come up with stuff like this. And most names lend themselves easily to a nickname that ends with A. Gazza, Shazza, you know, all that lot. And Mucka was the nearest they could come. I just think that's a bit weak, don't you? The Peephole. Jade... Toy boy in CD romp with blonde. See, this is more like it. This is your red top tabloid of a Sunday. Posh to sign up for X Factor. And, Kerry Katona. Who's that again? All of these people on the front page of the tabloid, I've got no idea who they are anymore. I feel
was
like
she
my
an
dad.
Atomic kitten?
Oh, God, one of those. Kerry Katona has sensationally confessed to having wild drug and drink binges as her life fell apart. My drugs and booze shame. Another one of these. You know, if your career's on the slide, all you have to do is go to Max Clifford or wherever in between you might want to employ and just say, oh, I know, I'll do a drugs and booze shame thing. Yeah, I used to do cocaine and I used to hoover up Mount Etna-sized quantities of cocaine and now I'm ashamed about it. And they'll throw it on the front page and then you'll pop to the Priory for a week. And then your career will be in takeoff again. She'll be on Celebrity this, that and the other, and Radio 1 will give her a contract. And, oh, struth. And my problem is I don't take enough drugs. I don't have a drugs and drink shame. I'll have to manufacture one. I'll just make it up. That's on front page of the Peephole. Inside, it's more people I don't know. Is anybody actually interested in Peter Crouch's girlfriend? Could you name her? I'll give you £1 million if you can name her. You're thinking. Microphone up when you're thinking. I want to hear you go,
Sophia.
Oh, no, time's up. Abigail Clancy. Drugs blotted out pain. Binges at wild parties and so on and so forth. anyway. The stuff that is in the people is just exactly the sort of thing that people who buy the people like. And finally, the front page of the Daily Star, Geldof daughter shock. Is Peaches a snorty girl? And a picture of her appearing to smell a rolled-up banknote. What does a rolled-up banknote smell like?
Ink.
Victory.
So we love the smell of a rolled-up banknote
in the morning. Yes, about 5 o'clock in the morning. It gives you so much vim and vigour. Hello, Rob. It's Robert from the Rondo.
Oh, thank you, Nicholas. I'm very tired, actually.
Oh,
before you came to me, I was yawning.
Baby.
I'm like, don't you yawn sometimes? You're really achy. You think your jaw's going to clam open.
Your achy, breaky heart.
Indeed. Been broken too many times. Like Cliff Richard. Do you find there's a lot of pointless celebrities in this country at the moment?
Do I think there are a lot of pointless celebrities in this country at the moment?
That's why I wouldn't vote in this country. A lot of pointless, irritating people that invade my life even if I don't want them to.
Yeah, they march into your living room without you bidding, yeah.
It's horrible. I mean, you can't avoid it. I mean, TV in this country got so bad that I've actually... Well, my parents have cancelled Sky this week.
What?
Yeah.
Your parents have cancelled Sky?
Yeah.
Well, there's a reason to leave home.
Well, yeah.
Cancelled it?
Yeah.
Why?
Well, partly because we're moving house, but I just don't discount it. It's pointless. We don't watch anything on there. Anything we do watch is free anyway. There's nothing on. I mean, there's about, what, 90 shopping channels and endless rubbish.
Yeah, when you get up into the high numbers, then there really is nothing on, yeah.
Oh, it's shocking. And, yeah, I don't even know half these channels are. Legal TV is a new thing I've been watching.
What's that?
It's a law channel, I guess.
The law channel?
Yeah, more or less. So, yeah, it's rather cheap. You get people, sitting, in a room and debating, immigration, legal aspects of the day.
Right. What's the point of putting that on? I don't understand. I mean, it must cost a certain amount of money to have a TV channel, right? I mean, even if you've got... it's just a kid with a handy cam.
Well, there was some channel this week got revoked because it didn't pay its licence to Ofcom, which was £2,000.
Which one was that?
I think that was a shopping channel.
E4?
E4, yeah.
Hey, you know what's coming back on E4, I think it's next weekend? The Sopranos. Isn't that thrilling?
Never seen it.
You've never seen The Sopranos?
What?
Are you kidding?
The thing I think of, American program I think I watch occasionally is Will and Grace. That's about it. That's
right, well, that ceased to be funny a long time ago.
Yeah, so, and I bought the first, because I never saw the first series, I bought it off eBay, and the cow I bought it off never sent it to me.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, another shocking eBay result.
He's going to send me a message saying, I've contacted the post office, but they're not doing anything about it. All right, I'll give you a bad rating then, love.
Oh, yeah, that'll really teach her. What is that going on in the background?
My flatmate's talking to me on the computer. Oh, he's going now, right. Sorry.
Right, hit mute.
Yeah, I wish I'd do it with a laptop, and that's bugging me as well. Anyway, what's going to get...
You'll be lucky if it won't explode right in your face. A laptop, you say? You insane?
Batteries and things, aren't they? Anyway, you were talking about MySpace last week.
Yeah.
Briefly, and you want to know why Neil Rogers has got you. Was that his name? Yes.
Okay, well, somebody tried to explain this to me on an email at the place that I work during the day.
All right.
And I'm not sure I got it. I don't understand why... On MySpace, which is one of the most successful sites in the whole wide world. Rupert Murdoch owns that, doesn't he?
Yeah, he bought it for $500 million.
Yeah, it was probably a good buy. But people have set up a MySpace account in my name, which means that if I ever decide in the future to set up a MySpace account, I won't be able to use my own name. But they've got people who are friends of mine who don't even know me. And I'm just mystified by that. I don't get it.
What are you going to do? I wouldn't think of them as friends as such, as other people connect who like your profile and add you. But to be added, you have to accept them.
Right, well, I haven't accepted them, and neither would they have asked to be added.
Well, you don't accept them because it's about you doesn't mean you run it. Somebody else runs it.
Yeah, but Neil Rogers would not ask to be my friend.
And
he just wouldn't.
Likewise, I don't think Neil Rogers runs his thing. A fan has done that. So it's kind of two fan bases. Connecting over the internet.
Huh. And when do you get to have sex?
As soon as you want.
Isn't that what it's all about? I mean, it's either actual sex, if they can find somebody in their locale, you know, like a real friend, like in the real world.
What's that again?
Yeah, precisely. Or it's sex by robots.
I've never had sex off here. Oh, no, almost people on there are ugly.
Huh.
Computer geeks.
Computer geeks. Well, isn't everyone, all kids are computer geeks now. You're a computer geek. I'm a computer geek. We should celebrate our geekness. And anyway, I've got to go.
Stuff sick.
You called it a very bad time. It was midnight. They said it was 12 o'clock.
Yeah. It's 12 o'clock.
Well, close, but no cigar. Hey, Betty.
Oh, Nick, my darling, you're good. How are you, sweetheart?
It's you.
Who was that reading the news?
He was a very nice man. He's accurate in every way.
Was she standing up with a low-cut top on and a very short skirt with beautiful scenery behind her, or
I don't
sitting
think
on a sofa?
So. Probably crouching in a corner. I think he'd be crouching in a corner right now, holding his head in his hands.
Oh, you're gorgeous. Listen, darling, you know Philip was saying about Ronnie Millsap. I met Ronnie, the blind pianist in America.
He's a blind what now?
Pianist.
Oh, pianist, yes.
Years ago. Did you remember? You probably didn't remember. It must have been at least 15 minutes ago. Philip from South Norwood was talking about Ronnie Millsap.
Rings a vague bell.
Vague bell, yes. He wasn't much. Listen, do you remember Winifred Atwell, the pianist? Winnie Atwell, black and white rag. You must remember it, my darling.
Well.
Was big in the 40s.
Oh, right. Was she? I was dead. I wasn't alive in the 40s.
Well, your parents were. They must have told you about Winifred Atwell.
They passed me on a lot of records. I haven't actually got around to them
yet. She was a Brixton girl. You know that?
Really?
She was one of the first people that came over from the West Indies. I'm not sure where she came from. I'm doing a Philip now.
Have you got a list for us?
I haven't got a list. Listen, what's this I hear about Heather McCartney doing a sex room? That's a bit inappropriate. Can't wait to rush out and get the papers.
Yes. Yeah, it'll be all over all of them, I imagine.
Well, there's a surprise that she's been sex romping, isn't it? What? I nearly died when I heard that. Anyway, what have you been up to?
Well, I had a birthday this week.
Huh? Oh, happy birthday.
Happy birthday to me, yeah.
Gorgeous, 33?
46.
You're joking.
Would I kid you?
Oh, I can't believe it.
I can't believe it.
You're almost getting a bit old for me. I'm going off you now.
I'm nearer 50 than I am 40, and I haven't even got used to being 40 yet.
Listen, I'm 59, and I'm still going strong, my darling.
Well, you sound every minute of it.
29 to the 3rd, 47. Do your arithmetic. That's
not
me.
Now. Not now. I can't do arithmetic now.
No.
Not even at the best of times.
Anyway, listen, my darling. Smelling rolled up banknotes, totally inappropriate.
Yeah, you don't know where they've been, apart from anything.
You know they're full of germs, my darling.
Yeah, horrible.
And you know in Australia they devised one, I'm doing a Philip again, they devised one that'll go through the washing machine. I used to wash mine regularly, not that I had many of them. They're filthy things, my darling, banknotes.
I've occasionally washed money and it comes out fine.
Well, the English doesn't. It's made from cheaper paper, as you know, my darling, but the Australian ones last for years.
Do they have real money in Australia?
Well, you can do a bartering sort of thing.
Right.
Which I used to do occasionally, but I always felt I wasn't getting value for money, if you know what I mean, darling.
With, you barter with chooks.
Oh, chooks! I haven't heard that expression for years, but I thought they were foul.
They are, yeah.
They are as well. Well, I don't know whether I've got anything else to say, Edwin.
Well, no one asked me what I got for my birthday yet.
What did you get for your birthday? That was going to be my next question.
I'm glad you asked, Betty.
Hang on, I'm ticking. There, I've just ticked it off.
You're ticking?
What did you get for his birthday? I've ticked it. What did you get for your birthday, darling?
I got the same as everyone gets for their 46th birthday.
I hope you didn't get what I got for mine.
Piles.
I can remember that one. I don't mind saying. What did you get?
You stepped all over it. I can't go back.
Don't drag it down, my darling. Listen, Brenda wants to come back. She's not happy with Australia.
Who's Brenda?
My half-sister from Brighton.
And she's in Australia.
She went back to Australia.
It's like a fight, isn't it?
You go.
So she went to Australia.
She went back to Australia 6 years ago, claimed she was burnt out of Brighton. She'd been there 10 years, went back to Australia. She's sick of it. She wants to come back. I don't want her back, basically, and I don't know how to tell her.
You could say, I don't want you back.
Well, I've said that, but she thinks I'm singing. Now, listen, since the accident, you know, her business with her hair and the wig and everything, we don't get on all that well.
Right,
she wants to come back. She'll be over here. She'll be muscling in on all my successful relationships.
And how many successful relationships do you have going right now?
Well, I can only admit to one, obviously.
Right.
Because I don't want to
upset people.
Upset anyone.
Yeah.
But I've had successful relationships. I've had near marriages in the past, my darling, I don't mind saying.
Is that a euphemism?
I've been engaged a few times.
Is that a euphemism?
I don't know what a euphemism is. Can you explain it to me?
Yeah, it's one of those big brass instruments that sits at the back of an orchestra. A euphemism.
Oh, you're gorgeous.
You must have heard of one of those.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I've seen something similar to that once.
Yeah. I mean, it's usually with a larger rotund guy at the back, and he takes a big breath in and then blows out like that.
Oh. Disgusting.
Did you get any on you?
You know, I think I've been banned from Ian Lee's show.
Well, I wonder why.
I think it's because he's heard about me and John Gaunt, basically.
John Gaunt? John Gaunt?
You know, and Ian aren't all that friendly, you know that, don't you, my darling?
Well, I've got no idea, but really...
I want to fight John Gaunt.
Oh, well, good for you.
I want to sumo wrestle John Gaunt. Imagine being suffocated between his chins, my darling. My God, that'd be a way to go.
I'd pay a lot of money to see that, Betty. My money's on you.
Well, you sort it out, my darling. You'll be there.
I will.
I'll be the one with more makeup on.
I'll put some iron in your gloves, all right.
Oh, OK. Well, look, it's lovely to talk to you.
Always a pleasure.
I'm missing Clive. When's he back?
When's Clive back, boys?
Monday.
Monday, or I'm out of here.
Monday he's back.
Just as well. Not that I don't like Bob, I do, but no, Clive's my boy.
You've got to have the real thing.
I prefer it. Love to the boys anyway. They're tired. They want to go home. Don't yap on for too long.
All right.
Okay, sweetheart.
Thanks a lot, dear.
Whatever dirt you tell, baby, that's my Italian.
There's a little Italian in you, and not for the first time, I bet. It was Betty! This is a story about Italian corruption that's been sitting in my pile here for a... speaking of piles, it's been sitting in my pile here for... Am I sitting comfortably?
No!
Then we'll begin. And, I just can't believe this. The Mafia made... Guess how much the Mafia made? This is just in Italy.
Over what period?
Last day.
Year?
Well, let's just say a day.
2 million.
61 million.
A day?
A day!
What?
£61 million. This is in Italy alone. The Mafia made £61 million a day.
I'm in the wrong job.
They made it through protection rackets, bribes and illegal money lending, according to a new report. The report, which is compiled from government figures, show that Italy's four major criminal syndicates even managed to collect £25 million a day from major companies listed on the Milan Stock Exchange. Isn't that incredible? Revenues from the Mafia, which is made up of the Cosa Nostra in Sicily, in Calabria and Campania and Puglia. New turnover, which excludes income from drugs and gun running. Now, you'd think that they'd make more money from drugs than anything else, right? And probably gun running, too. But that's not including drugs, is £61 million a day. That puts the Mafia in Italy on a par with Fiat. It's that big. Isn't that incredible? The majority of the extortion occurs in Italy's south. Yeah, I heard about that. There is a definite difference between the south and the north. The north people, northern Italy, pride themselves on being industrious. Like Milan is a very industrious place. And everyone else in Italy just sits back, puts their feet up, and has an espresso. In order to give themselves more energy to do nothing. That's what the people in the north of Italy think about the people in the south of Italy. And countries are often divided in that way, aren't they? North and south. Like southerners here think of northerners as people who don't wear jackets in the winter. Women totter around on in white stilettos and nothing else, go from bar to bar. And people in the north think that we're just a bunch of soft southerners. Everybody from the north hates everybody from the south in almost every country you can think of. In fact, more general than that, everybody hates everybody else. Welcome to the world. Almost 1 in 10 members of the Italian parliament... This is, Italy. I mean, it's such a lovely place, and they've kept it so nice. I mean, all the buildings are 1 of 5 colours, which just makes it beautiful. And they haven't, you know, in the places that you go to on holiday, they haven't succumbed to that 60s blight that we have here, of these hideous concrete lumps of buildings that people are housing. I'm sure there are... they do exist somewhere in Italy, but nowhere that, that any sane person would want to go, right? Everywhere you go, the houses are either pink or yellow, or orange and green, yellow and purple and blue.
That's lovely.
Or however that song goes. Almost 1 in 10 members of the Italian parliament is either on trial, awaiting an appeal, or has a conviction, only a decade after the political classes were purged by anti-corruption prosecutors. Oh, they did a great job. 1 in 10 members of the Italian parliament is on trial. Stunning. Italy is also served by 25 MPs who have criminal convictions, the highest number ever recorded. Research by the authors of a new book show that another 8 politicians have been sentenced but are awaiting appeal, a process that can take years, while 17 are on trial and 19 under investigation. Italians believe that most of the people involved in running the state are Furby. That's not those little dolls that go crazy when you feed them water. That's not a Furby, is it? What's a Furby?
It's a Furby.
A Furby?
Like the little pets that were cuddly, like soft kind of things.
Yeah, but if you feed them water, they go crazy after midnight?
That's a gremlin.
That's a gremlin, not a Furby, is the correct answer. But that's not what they mean. Furby, or cunning. They think that most Italians believe that people involved in running the country are cunning, and politicians are sometimes described as differently honest. But the scale of the problem has appeared to have taken the authors of this book by surprise. This is a percentage we do not even see in the famously criminal states, such as the Zena state in Sicily, or even the Scampia in Naples. More than 3,000 politicians and state officials were put on trial for corruption during the Clean Hands campaign by prosecutors in the 1990s. So we think we've got it bad over here, but Italy is in a whole nother league. Hey, Tallulah. Oh, Tallulah.
Oh, hey. Hello, you.
Hello, you.
Hi. What? Yes.
I've taken you by surprise.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday to me. Thanks.
Yeah. You played this for me a few weeks ago, so there we have it.
Happy birthday to me now.
You, I can do what I want. It's my birthday.
I did do what I wanted. I went to see the Stones and, yeah, I had a good week.
Cool.
Ask me what I got for my birthday.
No, I'm not, because I'm not telling the truth anyway.
So, what's up, Tallulah?
What did you get for your birthday?
I'm not telling you.
Yeah, I thought so.
It wasn't even gift wrap. What did you do this week then, Tallulah?
I don't have forgotten already, but...
Oh, come on.
Oh, come on! The Willy-Bins, Germany...
Yeah, isn't that amazing?
It's not amazing, it's just the reason why I escaped.
It's the reason why what?
Why I escaped from Germany.
Well, because they were spying on you.
No, because it's their natural attitude to do things what you think can't be, but it's true.
Oh, and you escaped to here from that?
Yeah.
From the state imposing its will on you through fair means and foul?
What? Pardon me? What language do you speak there?
The state interfering with your business?
Well, to be honest, when I lived in Germany and I saw a police car, I nearly, you know what you say, you peed yourself or whatever.
Well, you better not on this show.
that's quite... No,
almost had an accident.
It's very scary. It's very scary.
Why?
Why? Because it's not authority. It's horrible. It's like when you don't look after your garden and your neighbor sees you, he approaches you with a frozen, you know...
With pursed lips, right. With a disapproval etched upon his brow, yeah.
Exactly. And here in England, it's, you know, people are people.
No, it's just the same here.
No.
Electronic spy bugs have been secretly planted in hundreds of thousands of household wheelie bins in order to determine what you're throwing out, and they're going to fine you if you throw out the wrong stuff. I think you've escaped to the wrong country, Tallulah.
No, why?
They're calling it Bin Brother.
but this is from Germany, isn't it?
Well, apparently the chips are from Germany, but the idea is all ours.
No. Hello. Where is it all happening?
Hello.
Hello, boys.
Where is it happening?
In Germany, isn't it?
No, it's happening here. Here is where it's happening. We've got the chips from Germany, but we're installing them here.
Oh, goodness me.
Exactly.
Oh, that's frightening.
So I would,
go back then.
I would gather up your parrot and board the first plane out of here.
Oh, no.
How is your parrot, by the way?
He is... Oh, I nearly shot him there.
So you nearly shot him?
Yeah. He's cool. But in the moment, he thinks he has to feed a family, so he's a bit out of his mind.
Well, that makes... a household.
Oh,
yeah.
Dang it.
He has to feed a family. I don't understand what you mean. What do you mean?
When there's a season, the budgie, especially when the budgie has got the...
I get you. He's eating for winter.
He thinks he's now about September when the new breed comes. He has to feed the woman that sits on the... So he...
He's eating for two. So you've consequently got one fat parrot.
No, he doesn't... He's on a diet. But he's asking for food all the time. And
well, maybe there's something in that. Wow. He's hungry. Feed him.
No, he's not hungry, just he's mad in the moment. But it finishes in a while.
He finishes?
Yeah, it finishes after September. It just finishes.
Well, you're going to put an end to it.
Nature does it all.
Nature will take its course.
Absolutely.
Right. So they don't actually sleep, do they? They don't, because we got a bunch of parrots outside our flat. Bright green things they are, and they squawk and they must have been released at some point. Someone didn't like, so just couldn't stand it anymore, and they released them into the wild, and they started propagating like fury. And now there is a big colony just near where I live.
Parakeets, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, those people say they were pulled over from making movies, and then they
just threw them away.
No. Huh. They came over to make movies, and then they just released them, and then, of course, they implicated multi-blooder.
Right, so the parrots came over thinking that they were going to get a job in show business.
Exactly.
And they're realizing the error of the enormity of their mistake, yeah.
Mm. Well, there we have it.
Well, it's like no business I know.
Well, happy birthday.
Thanks a lot, dear.
Okay, then.
Hey, I saw the Rolling Stones.
Oh, how was it?
I was really glad that I went. I was really glad that I didn't pay for the tickets. The band themselves, like I said earlier on, it's like they might as well have just phoned their performance in on a video phone, because they weren't... You know what? I don't think the band were actually very good. Keith Richards and Ron Wood didn't seem to be able to play the guitar very well. Is that possible? I mean, the amount of practice they've had, they're not virtuosos. They ain't Michael Schenker, that's for sure.
You cheeky monkey. No, you have to keep practicing. If you don't, you have rheumatism in your fingers, then you slow down.
They didn't seem to be able to pick out many notes. They just sort of strummed along. Mick Jagger, on the other hand, I don't know what he's taking, but I'd like some of it. I'd like a lot of it.
I think he's taking the same that I do.
He just sips of water and a lot of exercise.
Mm, exactly.
What do you take?
Maybe
you shouldn't tell us.
Exactly, maybe I shouldn't.
Yeah, okay. Best kept in the dark. All right. Just like your parrot.
Oh,
Thanks a lot, Tallulah.
Okay,
it was Tallulah. The amazing adventures of the popular practice of staging striptease acts at funerals has been banned by the Chinese authorities. Five women have been arrested in the police campaign in the Jiangsu province. The practice began because of the local belief that a large turnout at a funeral is auspicious. Entertainment was organised to maximise the appeal of the mourning ceremonies. And what kind of entertainment would really drag the crowds in? That's right. As Jiangsu became one of the wealthiest areas in the country, this extended to striptease acts, with some families hiring two troops. Actually, those two tunes don't go very well together, do they? Not at all. This one. And this one. Not happy bedfellows. The popular practice of staging striptease acts at funerals has been banned. We're missing out on so much by living in this country, don't you think? Hey, Myrtle.
Hi. Many happy returns of the day, whenever it was.
Thanks a lot.
When was it?
Wednesday.
Mine's today.
No one cares. We're talking about me.
All right, then. Be like
happy
that.
Birthday, Myrtle.
Thank
There's
you.
One for you.
Thank you.
How does it feel to be whatever you are?
80.
80. You made it. Everyone's thrilled.
Yes, I made it.
88. Now, here's a question, because I'm 46 and I don't feel, I haven't got used to being 40 yet. 30 seems old to me.
Well,
so,
I don't feel 80, it's just an age on a birth certificate.
Yeah.
That's all it is.
So, what big number have you not got used to yet? Because I haven't got used to 40, I can just about get my head around 30.
Well, I got used to 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, it's just there.
So you do feel,
I don't feel 80.
No, but you feel... Yes, I've passed 70, and you can relate to that.
Well, I've passed 70.
Well, I know you have, but mentally, I've passed 40, but I can't relate to that. It
no,
just
mentally,
seems...
mentally, I don't feel 80.
Right.
No, mentally, I still feel about 40.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it's good.
But physically, things start to,
Yes, unfortunately, physically, things do go a bit, haywire.
And you read in the paper all the time of these things that they invent and they've come up with, and you think, oh, great. If only they'd invented that, like, 30 years ago, then I'd be running around like a spring chicken right now.
Well, I'm still running around. I'm off to America on Tuesday week.
Where are you going?
New York.
Don't do it.
What do you mean, don't do it?
You're going on Tuesday?
I've been doing it practically every year for the past 40 years.
Why do you go to New York? Family?
I have friends who live out at the Hamptons.
Oh, very posh.
Yes.
Who's that, Puff Diddy?
No. But I have... I was at a house last year next door to his.
So these friends must be billionaires.
No, they're not. They're just two ordinary working people who retired from New York and moved out to Sag Harbour.
Yeah, but houses over there cost £10 million each.
They didn't when they moved out 30 years ago.
Oh, right, they're sitting on a fortune.
Now they are sitting on a fortune, yeah.
They should sell up immediately.
Well, they are, they're going to sell up and they've got a place in Florida, they're going to move down there permanently.
They could buy Florida.
Probably, just about.
If you're going to New York next Tuesday?
Tuesday week.
Tuesday week. Well, I would go to the airport now. You'll need to start queuing now.
I don't think so. My grandson went last Sunday, and he got away very easily.
How was it getting into the country at the other end?
It was fine.
Really?
Yes.
Well, I hear no end of horror stories.
I know you do, but I've yet to have one.
Huh.
I don't know what it is. Maybe I look honest or something, but I've never had any problems.
Well, yeah, I mean, who's going to check, I mean, really, logically, who's going to check a nice 80-year-old lady?
But I don't look 80.
Right, who's going to check a nice, mature woman?
that is true, yes.
Yeah, it just makes sense, does it?
No. Anyway, I hope you had a very happy birthday.
Well, I hope you had a happy birthday.
I'm going to have one.
You're going to have
well,
one?
It's the 27th today.
Oh, you mean today as in just turn
yes,
midnight
just
today
now.
Today?
Yes, just now.
Right, so what plans?
I'm going out for lunch with my family.
Lunchy munches?
Lunchy munches, and then I'm going to see James O'Brien and Steve Allen.
Do they know about that?
Yes, they do. James sent me two tickets.
Ah, right, they're in concert.
At the Hornchurch Theatre.
And what will they be singing?
Hornchurch.
Will they be doing a duet?
I shouldn't imagine
no,
so.
Me
one
either.
Of them's doing one
no.
half and one's doing the other.
Well, that sounds like it'll be really good.
I'm quite looking forward to it.
Where are you going to go for lunch?
I don't know. My children haven't told me.
Oh.
The surprise.
McDonald's?
I shouldn't think so.
Somewhere posher, I would think.
Somewhere a lot nicer.
The society that you mix in, yeah.
No.
All right, well, I hope you enjoy the Ritz.
Thank you.
Wherever it is you're going.
It won't be. It'll be somewhere probably in Essex.
Essex. Oh, what
yeah,
awful, awful children you must have. But anyway, listen, thanks a lot, Myrtle.
And have a happy time.
Cheers, dear.
Bye.
What a nice lady. And finally, chocolate bars containing psilocybin, a substance that is hallucinogenic, were found at Schiphol Airport in Amsterdam. The test showed that the dark chocolate contains psilocybin, a substance found in hallucinogenic mushrooms and considered to be a hard drug. They were discovered after police found a homeless man who had eaten one and confused their uniforms with wedding dresses.
Groovy.